I would like to welcome everybody to the Economic and Community Development Committee meeting for Tuesday, the 19th of July. Our Chair, Deputy Lord Mayor Henda, is away. She's on leave, and as Chair, Deputy Chair, I'm replacing her for tonight's meeting. Item one, just first of all, I'd like to read and acknowledge an acknowledgement of live streaming and recording. The Economic and Community Development Committee and the Finance and Business Services Committee public meeting will be streamed live and recorded for publishing to the internet. Please note that an audio and visual recording is taken of this meeting. This means that your presence at and any or all contribution you make to the meeting may be collected, used, disclosed, or published publicly by the Council, including transferring outside of Australia. Item one, acknowledgement of country. The Economic and Community Development Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on the traditional country of the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains and pays respect to the elders past and present.
Do we have a quorum?
We do have a quorum. We did check that at the start. I've been assured we have a quorum. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with the land. We acknowledge that they are of continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. Item two, apologies and leave of absences. I have two apologies for the meeting. Councillor, Deputy Lord Mayor Henda, the Chair, and Councillor Antic, who's also away. Item three, confirmation of minutes. I ask that the minutes, I seek a mover and a seconder to confirm the minutes of the Economic and Community Development meeting held on the 21st of June 2016, Councillor Sama, seconded by Councillor Wilkinson. I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Carried. Members, item four, public forum. We have nil, but we do have a deputation from James Levison, of the representative of the Cairo Group, who was asked to come and speak to item nine in regards to Travestock Laneway. And I would ask that Mr. Levison please come forward in order to be able to address the committee. And I also believe that a flyover has been prepared. And I would also like to acknowledge Theo Samaras, the developer. Mr. Levison, you have 5 minutes.
Thank you. Thank you very much, firstly, for acceding to the deputation, and secondly, for putting us on first. Much obliged. The matter that I'm here to talk to you about tonight is item nine on your agenda, which is the proposal for a declaration that Tavistock Lane be declared as a public road. Since the report that I think you would have was printed, we've had a chance to review it and in fact confirm on behalf of Cairn that Cairn is open to the option of purchasing that land if that were to be the course that was desired by the council. So that's a slight change to the approach that I think is set out in your report. I'm sure the administration will take you through that. What I wanted to do was just to explain the context to you. The existing state of Tavistock Lane is probably something that is relatively well known, but the context of this request from us is that there's a development application that's been lodged with the Development Assessment Commission for the development of a fairly large parcel that reaches from Frome back to Synagogue Place, essentially from Tavistock Lane as its southern boundary, and there's another lane just behind the church that runs parallel with North Terrace. So the Cairn Group essentially control most of that block. And I think that's shown in I'm not sure what page it is, but in the link in your agenda papers. It's link one, so it's the yellow highlighted parcel of land that's in Kyron's ownership. That application, as I said, is before the commission, and it will go through that process. It's a hotel and apartment building that will front Frome and student accommodation complex fronting synagogue with a cafe and restaurant. The design approach that's been taken, and I'll focus really at the ground level because that's what's relevant to this issue, has been to set back the building so that it's essentially widening the Frome Street footpath to wrap around the lobby and entry point to the hotel onto Tavistock Lane so that it, I suppose, activates it, makes it more accessible to have the drop-off and service functions for the hotel off Tavistock. Again, so that's not creating traffic or pedestrian or bicycle conflict on Frome. And because the developer controls the parcel of land at the end of Tavistock, to also open up that as essentially a thoroughfare through to Synagogue Place. And at that point, there'd be a cafe that spills out in that laneway and into Synagogue. So it would provide a one-way circulation and a pedestrian-friendly environment. Tavistock Lane, if you've seen the state of it recently, it's one of those historic anomalies that's not uncommon, I suppose, in this council area. There's no identifiable living owner around to maintain it, and so it's in a pretty untidy and unsafe state. It's a dead end, vehicles have to reverse out on the Frome Road. It's certainly not a place to be at night time. What we're, I suppose, proposing at the moment is that because Kyron owns the adjoining land to the north and the block at the end of Tavistock, there's an opportunity now to, as part of this development, to open it up and change the status and change the accessibility. We see the benefits of those as being that the development can be oriented to Tavistock and Synagogue Place, provide that activation to an otherwise fairly dead and listless laneway, maintain Frome Street and its access and accessibility and the potential for bike paths and other features along Frome Road. So it's improving what is currently a pretty unsatisfactory arrangement. Now, it's not critical to this development that this happen, but I think we see it as a better result for the city that's improving that lane. Of course, it is still possible for the development to proceed without it, but that's not a result that's as good as what's proposed. So the benefits would be connecting to Synagogue Place over private land that's not otherwise available, improving the condition of Tavistock Lane, improving the traffic circulation in Synagogue and Tavistock, better pedestrian activation, a safer pedestrian environment, and more active and engaging face to Frome Street. That's my part.
Mr. Levinson, you do have you can sum up, and if you've got the flyover, we could also
sure.
do that.
Yep. Kyron has a track record of working with the council on walkways and public-private walkways and laneways. You'd probably be familiar with Paxton Walk, Vaughan Place, Gillies Lane, and the Mill Street, Cobham Street walkway. That's all part of Kyron's past capability. And as I said at the outset, Kyron's open to purchasing of this lane as an option if that was acceptable to the council. Just to give you an idea of the proposal, and I might take you through all of it, but not all of it's relevant. There's a fly-through which gives you a bit of a feel for what is proposed. I apologise for the music. So this is coming south along Frome. That's the existing car park that would be narrowed. And we're looking at the Frome. We're about to see the corner with Tavistock Lane come through on the left-hand side of the screen. So there's the lane. Suddenly goes skywards, very unhelpful for a little while. have. So you just need to bear with this bit. This has got very little to do with the loan. You will plunge down very quickly and then approach from the Rundlesford end. So we're now closer to the Rundle Prime Junction and we'll drop down and head back in towards the lane. So you see Amalfi's on the left and there's the lane. You see the wraparound of the lobby coming into the lane. This is now in Tavistock Lane. Now about to the end of where Tavistock Lane ends. This would be the component that is currently owned in private land. It'd be opened up onto the cafe and spill out area in Synagogue Place. And this is the student accommodation building. And we go skywards. So that's it. So it's 26 in the student accommodation and 36 in the new accommodation.
Thank you, Mr. Levinson. Just to bring Councillor Abbeyard up to speed, we just had a deputation from Mr. James Levinson of the Clyro Group, and I now open it up to questions. Councillor Mullany has a question.
Thank you. Thanks, James. You mentioned the option of purchasing over. Converting to a public road. The consideration we have tonight is for a public road, but with the commitment to investigate with developer whether they'd upgrade the lane. Can you just give your position on that?
Yes, so that I think was written when it was understood that Chiron wasn't interested in a purchase of the lane. There's obviously several processes that would need to be followed. The first is whether or not the council decides to proceed with the process of declaring what is a private lane a public road. So that's if you like, the first step, and that's really the question I think that confronts you this evening. So if that were to happen, then there are several other steps, and they depend a bit on which option is taken, whether it's declared a public road and left as a public road, whether it is declared as a public road but then closed following the Roads Opening and Closing Act process, yet further consultation for that to occur, in which case it could then be sold to the adjoining owner. So at this stage, I think that resolution or that recommendation has been outdated, and I defer to the administration. I don't know exactly what the recommendation is before you, what they might put to you, but the one you have at the moment has probably been surpassed, and the question would really be...
Yeah, we can ask that question during the...
Well, actually, I might just ask for Justin to comment on that.
Just very briefly, once the deputee has responded to some questions, we'll provide an administrative comment about an alternate recommendation we want to put before you tonight, on the basis that since this report was written, we've received a letter from the Chiron Group confirming they're open to the purchase of the laneway, which was not the case when the report was written. So if you can direct your questions to the deputy, and then we'll provide a full context of a proposed alternative motion for you to consider following the questions.
This is just Councillor Mullany.
It's a follow-up question though. Should the group purchase, I'm interested in the approach on adjacent property owners that would also want to access that space. Yes. What your position on that would be?
Yes. The process that the council would have to follow includes consultation on the road closure process, So those adjoining owners would have the opportunity to participate in that consultation, and one would expect that there would need to be rights of access. That's more or less what's proposed here anyway, bearing in mind that at the end, that is at the synagogue place end, we're already proposing a right of way that would enable public access across it. So those sort of rights following that consultation would need to be addressed.
Councillor Wilkinson.
If the road was to be made public and then closed and then sold to the hiring group, would that not permit or enable the hiring group to then basically build over that right way, the larger footprint building, even if it provided ground access? It seemed to me that the only reason why there would be a desire to purchase this land would be to do an even bigger building that actually overhangs that right of way, as opposed to just retaining as a street and having a building stop at that line.
I suppose the short answer is I don't know of any plans to build over and just simply have a tunnel over that section. But that could be dealt with by the terms on which the sale is to take place. For instance, the height of any easements or restrictions that are imposed on it. So if that were a concern, for instance, it could be addressed that way.
So well, I mean, what purpose does it serve, really? You know, if it's going to be a street and Kyron Group's going to provide hotel access to the north, properties to the south get vehicle access to the south, but it's basically open as a street. Why is there a desire to purchase it at all?
I think the issue is really just one of a comparison of the public road construction requirements versus a private road construction requirement, that it's there's less administration and engineering that would be undertaken for something that's a private thoroughfare compared to something that the council has to bring onto its asset book as a public road. Right. There's a greater degree of probably due diligence and risk management that you as the council would have to adopt at a greater cost to somebody versus that being done as a private laneway with the benefits that is publicly accessible, but not necessarily all of the same infrastructure and due diligence costs that public authority would bear.
Yeah, often the development work that I do, the developer can pay for their space on the road that they want.
Councillor Wilkinson.
I take it you'd have no objection, therefore, to the requirement that it be open above completely as a public street. That's not being sorted.
I don't think we're at that point, but obviously that's something that would need to follow through the public consultation process and the submissions that you might receive, not just on the declaration to proceed with the private public, but then on the roads opening and closing act process, and what other rights of access other adjoining owners might want, how that might need to be accommodated. So yes, all of those things would need to be addressed, and there's several steps before the council would make any final decision on them.
If there are no other questions, I would like to thank Mr. Levinson for his time and for coming in here today, and also Mr. Samaras as well. Thank you very much for your time.
Thanks for the chance.
Now, I would like to flag with the elected members that it is my intention to bring forward item 9 and also to ask for the Justin to provide some commentary around item 9 in relation to Travestock Lane and a possible alternative motion. Yes, and I seek Justin to provide some commentary.
Yeah, I'll defer to Mike to provide that detail. Thank you.
Through the chair, as noted in the deputation, we received a letter yesterday which I guess provided written support for the appetite for the developer to purchase the land instead of undertaking the work to public road standard and declaring the road a public road. In the event that council members choose to pursue that as an option, and without entering into a debate on that, the recommendation would need to change substantially. And fundamentally what it does is it now brings into play the Section 210 of the Local Government Act, which talks to declaring a private road public, and then simultaneously talks to the Road Opening and Closing Act, which closes that road, and different sections of the Act then allow council as a local government authority to sell that road at independent valuation to the owner following a public consultation process. Now, during that process, the public are consulted as to the merits of closing that road, including dealing with the adjacent owners around their rights and rights of access, particularly to ensure that all of that is caught up in a deed of settlement.
Okay, well, actually the administration have provided an alternative motion. Item 9, original recommendation is in front of you. Can I just ask that it be brought down to the alternative? Councillor Mullany has a question.
Yeah, thanks, Mike. Mike, I just want to ask about the process in terms of there might be other property owners adjacent that laneway that would equally like to acquire that laneway. How do we create an even process here and transparent?
Through the chair, under the Road Opening and Closing Act, each adjacent owner has the right to submit an offer to purchase if council's desire to actually close the road. So that that's part of the process, and that would need to be dealt with through the consultation.
Okay, I'm just going to give everybody a little bit of direction here. We've got two options. I do need a mover and a seconder. It depends on what the committee's desire is. The original recommendation was to close the road. The new one is with the vision of selling the road. And
can you show us around?
I'll just pause and give you a moment to read the alternative motion, and then I'll call for a mover and a seconder of either or, and then we can go into debate and questioning.
Chair, I'm happy to reveal.
Okay, I've got Councillor Abiyad. After a moment of time to review it.
And what about background information?
There doesn't appear to be any background information that accompanies the new proposal.
Chair, would you be comfortable if we did a little bit of questioning of administration before which time you look for someone to move either or? Because I think there might be some contextual information the members might want to know before we go into some
debate. Okay. All right. Given that, I'm comfortable after we've had a time to have a look at this. I'll leave it up on the screen. I'll give handball it back to Justin. And then after that, I'll seek a mover and a seconder.
Yeah, I believe that what would be of benefit to the elected members if Mike actually talked through the recommendations and each of the steps of the process. He's provided a very superficial high-level response or commentary that there's two pieces of legislation that are now need to be potentially invoked in terms of achieving an outcome. So I'd suggest that Mike actually talks through the recommendations and presents that information. The only thing that's changed from the time that the report was written was the developer's indication that they're prepared to look at purchasing the laneway. At the time of writing the report, that indication hadn't been provided. So the report was written on the basis that that road would come across into public ownership and council would have a role to play in terms of bringing it up to a public road standard. The recommendations that are provided, which I'll get Mr. Philippou to talk you through, delivers the same outcome to the Chiron Group, which is the access to the building, but deals with all these issues that I'm sure you've got questions about, which includes access and rights of the existing property owners and what the process is. So, Mike, if you can just talk through the process.
Excuse me, just a point of order. I mean, this is basically a motion without notice, without backup. I'm not comfortable voting for this tonight at all. I feel I'm being railroaded into it. The first motion was quite understandable to make it into a public road, which achieved all the things for the Kieran Group. Now suddenly we have a motion to sell it to them without having spoken to anybody else. I think it's very dangerous to proceed with this, and I suggest that we defer this for a full briefing.
Justin, can
I not vote on this?
I'm happy to second that.
I'd like Justin to just provide.
Yeah, as I just indicated, I believe if the councillors will indulge, if Mike talks through the recommendations, I'm very confident that you'll get a level of comfort that all this resolution does is to start the process. As the deputy indicated, there'll be a number of steps of the process, and if we can just get Mike to talk to the recommendation that's been put forward.
I'm not going to be talking to something on the floor where this involves money.
Councillor Moran, actually what I've decided is I've asked for the administration to provide us some background, which they're doing. After that we'll have some questions, and then I've got actually Councillor Abiyad who's coming before you and has flagged that he wants to move something.
He wants to move that we sell it. There can be no background because this motion has just...
Point of order, Chair, please. No councillor should be speaking on this motion until you make that decision.
I've just reiterated my position, which is that the administration have provided us with some comment and then we'll have time for question and answer.
Look, I move to dissent from the ruling of the Chair. And Councillor Moran seconds that. It has been proposed as an amendment that this matter be deferred, but there is no basis on which to review.
There was a move before that for me to move the...
But there was no seconder. There was a move and a second.
I did flag that I was moving.
All right, I'm suspending this meeting until I have the opportunity to hear some advice and then we'll bring it back in.
I'm happy for you to have advice.
Elected members, thank you. I would like to formally reopen this meeting. I've sought some advice from the administration in regards to what dissenting from the chair means, as I haven't heard it before, and I'm deputy chair of this committee. So I'm of the understanding that once that's been called, we need to vote on whether or not that is accepted. If it's successful, then we go to Councillor Moran, who has suggested that we defer, and it's in her intention to defer. If it's not successful, we go back to my original plan, which is what I've communicated twice now, that the administration provide us with some comment, and then we have some question and answer time, and then we will go to Councillor Abiyad, who will move either the original recommendation or the new alternative recommendation provided by the administration.
good door.
I'm of the understanding that Councillor Martin moved the intention to dissent from the chair and that it was seconded by Councillor Moran. So now I seek those in favour of the dissent to vote. And those against?
You can vote.
It's lost. The dissent is lost, therefore we go back to my original plan and I seek the administration to comment.
Through the chair, if I could perhaps bring a little bit of clarity, that the recommendation that was put into the papers and in paragraph 17 of the report talks to the fact that there isn't a desire of the developer to purchase the land. Now that opportunity has come up as of a letter addressed to council yesterday. It's not a preferred opportunity, it's purely there as an alternative. So I wonder if it's just helpful if I could take a little bit of your time just to talk through the nature of the report, and then ultimately council can choose really which way it wants to go. If it doesn't want to sell, that alternate recommendation was only put up in the event that council chose to take that route. The first point that council needs to, or committee needs to come to a view on, is whether the proposition is something it wants to entertain in the first place, and then secondly, how it entertains it. So what's before you are two recommendations on how it would entertain it. So if I could just take a little bit of time to talk through the report. You've heard from the deputy and seen the fly-through, which shows in some ways the reliance on Tavistock Lane to service a hotel lobby from that side and for have a taxi pick up and drop off. In order to do that, the current road, being Tavistock Lane, is no longer or isn't in, or we can't find the owner, so the developer has no rights over that laneway. There are provisions within the Act, and that's section 210 of the Local Government Act, which provides local government the opportunity to determine who the current owner is via consultation, and if in the event it chooses to, after consultation, to declare a private road public, and then it becomes part of council's road register and part of its asset management plans going forward. If council chooses to then sell that land, it relies on another part of the Act, which has been before you many, many times before, which sells a public road privately, and that's under the Road Opening and Closing Act, and that will follow another consultation, which following independent valuation and rights being determined, would see the sale of that put into private hands. So that's the mechanics of the process. The report and the recommendation that are in your agenda papers only is half that process. It's only the Local Government Act that takes it from a deceased estate, privately owned roadway into public hands. That's the context that sits behind the road, and that request has come from the developer to service the need for the access to its proposed hotel lobby area and to service a taxi pick up and drop off.
Councillor Mullany.
Thank you. A recent topic has been around private lanes and the ability for how council ensures that they're maintained to a certain level. Can you talk us through what council could do if it was to be become private and sold, what we would have as leverage to do that?
Through the chair, the leverage would come in the form of a deed of settlement for the sale of the land, and that, like any sale of land, those are commercial negotiations that would play out. Traditionally, what council has done is sought for unrestricted rights of way for pedestrian movement, so basically the general public can traverse the site, and any other particulars that might play out. Those particulars are often brought to the attention of of DAC through the road closing process, and DAC's the approval authority there, which looks to ensure that the needs of the adjacent owners are met. So in that regard, it's their access. It might be issues around waste management and how they deal with that. It might be some form of surveillance or treatments to the pavement and so on and so forth. All of those things, whilst not in council's control, can be facilitated through the conditions of the road closure that DAC would have visibility to.
Including levels of maintenance. And if it was remained in as a public road under council's domain, have we got any indication of what the maintenance costs of this would be?
Through the chair, without undertaking the due diligence and understanding of what the quality of the amenity is intended, we haven't got that information. But if we had some view about that, or understood what the intent of the amenity is, not trying to be funny with words, if it's bitumen, it'll carry one maintenance stream. If it's paved, a different one, depending on the curb and gutter that plays out, public lighting and all those sorts of things. If we understood that, we would be able, we undertook an investigation into that, we'd be able to understand what the maintenance regime would look like.
Councillor Wilkinson and then Councillor Martin.
I understand from the explanation given there that the Chiron Group currently doesn't have rights over this land at all, and therefore the development in its current format, which relies on vehicular access off Tavis Glen, can't actually happen unless council agrees to
that. I just want to reiterate that it's no debate at this time, it's simply questions.
Yeah, so I'm just getting clarification, is that the situation?
Through the chair, as far as where we've been able to ascertain, the only owners that have rights over the lane are the adjacent owners to Grundle Street.
Right. So that means that there would be an opportunity for council through the process that it goes through in deciding whether or not to go down this path, has an opportunity to negotiate with the developer some, you know, aspects of the development. There's leverage.
Through the chair, if it's in relation to the road access and the ability to service adjacent properties, I think that would be right. If it's about the quality of the development, that the approval authority is DAC, so we will be playing the role we would normally play with DAC. Providing comments to DAC in regard to the development. That's a fairly high level response. I wonder if you need more detail, then we've got some development officers from our planning area that might be able to assist.
I think if we are actually in control of the process about the roads open and closing, that therefore there would be some opportunity for council to have influence on the decision beyond that.
No debating, just questions. My apologies, I missed the Lord Mayor, who flagged prior to both of you that he had a question. So I'll go to the Lord Mayor, then Councillor Martin, and then Councillor Moran.
Thank you. Question through to Mr. Philippou. We've got two possibly pleasant scenarios in front of us, because whatever happens, this laneway is going to be improved. I think we welcome that. But Mr. Philippou, my question is, the nub of this issue possibly gets down to the access, amenity and enjoyment of adjoining property owners, and also access, and we've touched upon this in various discussions, maintenance by council or the owner, in whatever case it might be, and also, of course, rubbish collection and access. In your professional opinion, and this is an important question, in your professional opinion, are both outcomes both equitable in terms of achieving those three priorities, or does one more favourable than the other? Well, it's an important question to ask, because it is a very important question to ask.
Frank and fearless, come on, Mark.
I just hope we find the buyer, the owner.
Because I'm not going into the debate, but that is a very important technical question for us to know before we do debate.
Through the chair, I don't think there's one that's an advantage over the other. I think they're both valid, provided that the one's going to be the commercial terms of an agreement that talk about how council would sell the land, as it'll be a real estate transaction that will have a commercial deed sitting behind it as a contract of sale. The other one would be being if council kept it in public ownership, it would basically be to the standards that council would need to maintain to build a road to public road standard with the appropriate safety and surveillance and risk management strategies that are in place on any public road that council owns.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Martin and then Councillor Moran.
Thank you, Chair. A question for the administration. Last year, I proposed and council agreed that as a matter of policy, whenever a process was suggested to sell public land, that the administration would prepare a report on possible future uses looking forward decades ahead that may or may not influence a decision to vote in favour of that sale. Now, I see the information is not here. Is it likely to be provided to us tonight?
It's not public land right now.
Well, no, that's the proposal.
Through the chair, the report that's before members at the moment is not public land. It's basically privately owned, and there's provision in the Act that allows local government to undertake this process to make it public land.
Yes, but I understand that. But what you're asking us to do is to vote on a proposal to begin that process leading ultimately to the sale of the public land. So, in effect, the process that was anticipated in the motion last night is inferred by what's happening here tonight. And I'm saying to you, does that information exist or has it not been prepared because of the haste with which this has been presented?
Through the chair, the proposal before you is about a commencing a process for public consultation in order to have council consider the public's view on the acquisition of this road via section 210 of the Local Government Act. It doesn't commit council to actually finalising that, it commits to a public consultation process occurring. The reason for the acquisition of the or the sale of that site is a separate process which have to come back to council in a different form, but the process of consultation or the first step remains the same, and that is to investigate who the current owner is, which we believe to be part of a deceased estate, and under those terms, if a current owner is not found, council has the power to acquire that land under the Act.
Councillor Moran and then Councillor Gorry.
That's my problem. You're asking us in the second motion, correct me if I'm wrong, to do two steps, to say declare it public, then go and sell it. I'm not prepared to do that in this meeting. So it's not like you're just asking us to start a process. You're asking us to choose whether we eventually sell this public land or we make it public. So I think the only one that can be moved that I'd agree with is the first one.
Yeah.
Which is on the agenda, and I ask that we, if they want to bring it back at some stage after consulting, do that. But we can't possibly agree to sell. This is agreeing to sell it. The proponents in the audience, if we vote for this, we are selling, and that is not something we should decide in case.
What's the question there, Councillor Moran?
Is that the case?
just to give Michael a little reprieve from the questions, the intention of the second or the alternate motions was if we're going out, not if, the we're asking council whether you want to go commence a process to go to the public to talk about converting Tavistock Lane from private to public. In going out to the community, the intention of this alternate motion is to be very clear to the community that this process is being done in order to potentially transfer or sell that road in due course. But you'll note the way that it's worded, that the second one talks about in principle. So it's just to say you either in principle believe that that may be the outcome or not, and you commence the process very clearly with the community, very transparently about what the potential outcome may be. And it goes on then with item three to say that the sale and transfer of the lane will be subject to a successful road closure process, which is a separate step of the process. You need to undertake consultation under the Opening and Closing of our Roads Act, specifically around the potential sale. So we've tried to foreshadow what the steps of the process is to be very clear to the community when we go out and talk about the merits or otherwise of converting this road, currently private road, to public ownership in the first instance. The recommendation that was in your report leaves that ownership ultimately with council. The alternate recommendation foreshadows the potential for the ownership to transfer to private ownership through a multi-step process.
I actually need to adjourn this meeting, and then after that I've got Councillor Farahan, Councillor Mulani and Councillor Slama who have indicated that they have questions. I need a mover and seconder so that we can move into the Finance and Business Services, moved by Councillor Abiyad, seconded by Councillor Vershaw. All those in favour? I declare the meeting adjourned.
I declare the meeting of the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting open on Tuesday the 19th of July 2016 at 6:20 p.m. and I seek someone to adjourn. Moved by Councillor Mulani, seconded by the Lord Mayor. Any debate? Be it that there's none. All those in favour of adjournment. All those against? That is carried.
I reopen the Economic and Community Development Committee meeting and we move back to questions. Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Mulani and then Councillor Slama.
I think it's the number two that's bringing a lot of us undone. I don't think anyone here would object to going through the road closing and opening or the closure and declaration of this street becoming public in order for it to be a public road where council maintains it, or in order for the sale of it, if that's the case.
Please, can I remind elected members isn't, to make their questions very clear?
Is it possible that if we remove number two from there so as not to show a hand, but to state that we want to declare this road public so that we can progress, would that prevent any progress on council taking action on this?
That's the original motion.
That's the original motion.
Yeah. Can I ask a substitute?
No, I just want to hear, excuse me, I just need to hear from the administration.
Through the chair, they are separate processes. So step one is always going to be, regardless of which direction council chooses to take, step one will always be declaring a private road public. That's under the Local Government Act, Section 210 of the Local Government Act.
Yep.
That has to happen regardless.
Yep.
The rest can be deferred. Now, if that's the case and that's the direction that committee the members want to take, that's fine. That's basically saying you're going back to the original recommendation that's within your agenda papers, and then through the fullness of time, council can determine how it wants to deal with the robot that's in public ownership.
Yeah, and one more question. What was the process that we undertook when we looked at, I think was it Thomas Street, in a recent road closing and sale, I think on the university University of South Australia campus? Was it the same process?
Through the chair, I'm not aware of that site, but we generally and quite often put reports to council on opening and closing of roads. And we historically have dealt with the closing of roads through the acquisition of a part road or full road to the adjacent owner for the purposes of development. Now, the basis under which we do that is whether that asset, that part of the road, has any value or public value to council, and that's how it's reported back to council. So it's fairly common for us to go through a road opening and closing process. The difference here is that the road we're talking about we don't currently own. So we've got two processes and they are independent of each other.
Okay, Councillor Mulani, then Councillor Palmer, and then Councillor Wilkinson.
Just a quick question, Mike. Is it possible for council to give approval to commence the consultation process but not give approve in principle the sale? Is that possible?
Through the chair, yes, that's the case. That's recommendation one.
In the interest of being a nimble, fast-moving council, which would you recommend is the quicker option?
In terms of process, the process to undertake the ownership elements in order to facilitate or to add value to the development that's currently before DAC, there's always the first process, and that will be the only process that will play out. Later on in the development process, we would have to deal and work closely and collaboratively with the developer to undertake the development of the public infrastructure that supports that, or determine how best that work would be undertaken through design approvals of public infrastructure by a third party.
Councillor Wilkinson, and that, if there's no further questions, Councillor Martin after that.
Given that the property, the site, subject doesn't have rights over Tavistock Lane at all, gaining rights over it would profoundly affect and increase the value of that site. Has some analysis been done as to what the uplift in value of the subject land would be if this process was embarked and rights, whether it's public or sold to the party, the uplift in value of that property?
Through the chair, we haven't undertaken that investigation.
Councillor Martin.
Yeah, look, just a quick question to the administration. The first I became aware of this was during the deputation. I'd like to ask the administration, were any other councillors aware of this proposed second amendment before I was and the meeting began?
Through the chair, the chair of the committee was made aware prior to the meeting. Other than that, there hasn't been any correspondence put forward. Like I said, it all happened late in the day yesterday. So we've been working to determine, in the event that council wanted to pursue an alternate route, what does that recommendation look like?
Thank you.
And final question, Councillor Abiyat.
Thank you, Chair. Just a quick question, and that could possibly assist me in forming a motion for after. So the first part of the process basically declares the road closure discussion, but it also goes out from a public consultation, possibly could also find who currently owns this, because we still can't determine the ownership of it. So potentially that dialogue could trigger that someone will come forward and say, look, I own this property. Is that correct?
Through the chair, that's correct.
Potentially, if that was to occur, then council has nothing to do with this, and there'll be a private matter to be dealt with.
Through the chair, that's correct also.
Which would be great. That gives me a lot of clarity on that. I'll stop it here.
Okay, well, thank you for your patience, members. We've had comments by the administration, we've had an opportunity for questions, and we've had plenty of those. Members, Councillor Abiyad registered his intention with me right at the start to move a motion as either option one, the original, which is to close, or the alternative motion. And I'll leave it to Councillor Abiyad.
So, look, I'm going to move the first recommendation with a change. So it would be 1, 2 and 3 as it is in 3.1 and 3.2. And then item 4, in addition, would be request a report from administration on the process of which a sale of the land can take place if council wishes to progress down that path. Let me change the last bit there. Take place if council, depending on the outcome of the public consultation. So let's do that.
Okay, and
so request a report from administration on the process of which sale of the land can take place if council wishes to progress, depending on the outcome of the public consultation.
Can I suggest a change there, Sam? Take into account, because you're basically saying that the consultation is the only thing you're taking into account, whereas we have views, and I'm happy to second it if you don't.
Councillor Moran is indicating she's...
So look, I'm happy, it's not going to make a big difference. Let's get the public consultation. Let's remove that. That's not going to be either you or there. So Councillor wishes to progress down that path, full stop.
Yeah.
Okay, so that's Councillor Moran is seconding. Councillor Abiyad.
Okay, look, this, we've had debates and the... I've never had Councillor Moran second anything I do. So.
I don't think we need down the path that path.
So,
carry out.
Before she gets back to us, Chair. So look, I think we've spoken enough about this. I think let's send it out to public consultation, understand the process. Hopefully someone will put their hand up and own it, maybe one of my cousins or someone, I don't know. We've got to find someone that owns this block of land, but potentially that could be the direction that it takes. After that, all the information will come back to council, which will satisfy to some degree also Councillor Wilkinson and Councillor Martin in relation to some of the questions they've got before we make a decision to move forward. In the meanwhile, it won't stop us going in other directions, but at least we'll be able to have all the information we need before we progress further. We'll be able to assess this on merit. So I'd ask members to support this.
Councillor Moran.
Yes, I think this is a sensible way to proceed. It's option one. Then in the future, once it's public and closed, if we decided to sell it, and then we can negotiate conditions, or we don't, we keep it ourselves and negotiate maintenance and so forth with the developer. It doesn't necessarily mean that just because we have to sell it to get them to do the infrastructure and the maintenance, that can be an either or situation, but that's something that takes a lot of thought when you're selling off public land, which it will become. I don't think we're in a game of handing over public land without a lot of scrutiny and a great deal of thought, and not a motion without notice on the night. So I think proceeding sensibly, there are many steps in this. We're taking two, and then the third step we'll ponder about sensibly. Thank you.
Councillor Martin.
Yes, look, I can support this too, but I would ask the move just to fix it up grammatically.
Yeah. English is not my first language.
No, I understand. Request a report from the administration on the process for the sale of the land if council wishes to proceed. That says it. Request a report from the administration on the process for the sale of the land if council wishes to proceed with the sale, if you wish.
Yeah.
And look, I endorse entirely the comments of Councillor Moran.
Just hang on a second. We need to make sure that the second vote's happy with this variation and the move vote's happy with this variation.
The same means.
Okay. So we're all okay with that?
Yep.
Can I have a show of hands, please? Thank you. Councillor
Martin. This is a decision that does need some consideration. I was given and read at length the briefing sheet for the first motion, and there was no additional information that I could study and satisfy myself that it was to be a reasonable process. I would welcome that opportunity when this comes back to council, have all the information I need to make the decision, and I may well agree to the sale of the landway. It's just that under the circumstances tonight, I felt I couldn't.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Wilkinson, and then the Lord Mayor.
My agenda paper just had links to web things which might crashed on Marble Run, had a couple of copies of that so I could assess this proposal. I'm happy to support this. I wasn't prepared to support that second one. I'm prepared to consider this. But I would say that we must take into consideration the very considerable uplift in value afforded to the owner of the adjacent land. I don't think we should be going down any process of declaring, you know, this old system land in the public road, and even potentially selling it to the adjacent landowner without taking into consideration the very significant uplift in the value of that property. That should not just be put to the side, that should be taken into consideration. And also, there is an opportunity for council through the process to actually negotiate an improved development of the site, that benefits from gaining the access that we would be, you know, affording access to, which makes the progress work. But you know, at the moment, you're seeing a building 36 stories high, sheer wall to Frome Street, for example, surrounded by a three-story building. You know that. So you know, there's historic buildings on the Tavistock on the street behind, which could be incorporated into the site, and we had the sale of Harris Garth site and things like that. So there's a number of things that could be finessed with the project that would enhance the development and make it a better project for all through this process. And I think council should be using its leverage through this process to actually get a better result for everyone, not just be facilitating this for the benefit just for the person in town.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Lord Mayor.
Thank you, Chair. I'll be brief. I just want to thank Councillor Abiyad. I think he's got the right motion. I think it provides all the necessary checks and balances, and I also hope at the same time it provides the developer who is potentially investing in our city very heavily, for which we're always thankful, some confidence that we're prepared to work collaboratively and move this ahead. So well done, Councillor Abiyad.
If there are no further speakers, then I'll move to the mover to sum up.
Summed up.
Okay, all those in favour? That is carried. Okay, members, item five now is the Chair's verbal report. The Deputy Lord Mayor Hender hasn't indicated to me that there's anything that she wished to report back on her behalf. So that's done. Item six is adoptions on block. We've already dealt with item nine in regards to Tavistock Lane. So all we have is item eight and item 10. Item eight is Smart Organisation, Smart City, if anyone, Councillor Martin, would like to pull that out. And item 10, Adelaide City Council Traffic Control Signal Operations. Okay, so we're moving item 10. I seek a mover and a seconder to adopt these items for recommendation and consideration to council. Moved by Councillor Abiyad and seconded by Councillor Salama. All those in favour? That is carried. Item seven now is a workshop, Smart City and Smart Organisation.
Through the Chair, thank you for the opportunity to present tonight about some of the work that we've been doing through the mid-year budget review that we did in QF2 in February this year. So today is really just about an update on some of the outcomes of that particular piece of work that will lead to some of the discussion about the Smart Org program that we're going to talk about later. So the program of work itself really focused on a couple of key elements of the underpinning building blocks that we need to create a smart organisation, and also looked at responding to a motion on notice that Councillor Mullaney had around creating a customer information portal for customers to see some of the work and create transparency about some of the work that's happening through council itself. Observations of the organisation and systems architecture, where we had quite a disparate environment, lots of systems, poorly connected. Our architecture itself wasn't really conducive to a smart organisation or a smart city. So we've done some work to really start to pull together some of the key building blocks to actually start to take the organisation forward. That includes things like overarching governance framework, quality systems, making sure we've got the right enterprise architecture in place to respond to council's objectives in their strategic plan, and making sure we're starting to build capability and capacity in our organisation to do things quite differently. Our current system landscape looks quite disparate, as I said, and we've got lots of systems that aren't really connected to each other or aren't connected to our customers. The future landscape we're looking at is really about creating a set of reusable building blocks across our organisations to respond both to our smart organisation ambitions and also our smart city aspirations. And really combining those custom combinations to really create that common user interface at the front of our systems. So instead of having multiple systems with different ways to interact with them, having that common interface that people can start to interact with our systems and information in a consistent manner. So really, that reallocation of funding that happened in QF2 really focused on that data management platform, which was a key issue for the organisation when I first undertook the review of our systems and information architecture. So that piece of work, not to get technical, but that piece of work actually turns into an architecture that looks something like this. Okay, I just wanted to step you through a couple of scenarios about how one particular piece of this architecture can deal with multiple issues for the organisation. So if we're to look at smart lighting, for example, smart parking out of our smart city ambitions, we bring together information from our sensory network across the city into this architecture to make better decisions. And in this example, we're showing a lighting head, for example, may have a failure that's about to occur, which can generate an automated job in our infrastructure systems to actually create a job to actually go and fix that light. But it also can bring together information to start to think differently about how we can actually see the value of these particular assets. So it might actually tell us information about the environmental conditions of these lights, or how much energy that we're actually saving for the organisation. Similarly, same architecture, a different experience. So here we're looking at, and I'll show you an example of a product that we produced in this, which was in response to Councillor Mullaney's motion on notice. So this is a direct integration to some of our internal systems to present information out to our customer base. So this is about creating transparency about the works that's going on through our city. And thirdly, better understanding of insights and analytics about what we're actually doing with some of the information across our organisation. So I'll just step through at first, switch into some of the work that we've been doing around the city insights piece of work. So just getting Sanjoy to drive from his side. So, this is the product that we've created, and this product itself is, whilst it looks quite simple, it's actually quite a complex interface back into our back-end system. So what you're seeing here is a subset of some of the infrastructure works that are happening across the city. And a customer could look at this on their PC at home, or on their mobile phone, or on their tablet. It doesn't really matter which device it's actually viewed on. But if you hover over any of these particular pins here, and at the moment we've just got a subcategory of all the works that's going on, but over the next few weeks we'll see hundreds of these pins across the city of particular works that are going on through different precincts of the city. So if I was to click on one of these pins, it gives me some information about that particular piece of work and who's the contact person within the organisation if the customer wanted to actually get some more information about what's happening there. So this is live, real-time information coming straight from our systems out to customers. We've also created a different view, so people that have got different accessibility needs can see this information in a different manner. So again, this is not about putting manual processes in the way of these things. This is a direct interface back into our system, so there's no real administrative overhead to get this information out to customers. I also wanted to show you some of the work we've done on the architecture itself around some of the analytics that we're actually starting to produce. So here's an example of information that DPTI and City Council itself actually share. So this information we've pulled together, and it's starting to show volumes of traffic coming in and out of the city. So we've mapped the ring road of the city, and we can see year on year different trends of movement of traffic in and out of the city. So I'm seeing traffic coming in 2013, or traffic going out, and I can do things like exclude public holidays. So from here, we're starting to see year on year different trending information about what's happening through our city. We've also used the same platform to create a different outcome. So understanding council's ambitions around carbon neutrality, how do we start to think differently about some of our information in our systems across our organisation? Where is that data held? How can we start to think differently about this? So again, using that same platform, here's an example where we can start to see information about how much, how many kilowatt hours we're using across different parts of the organisation. So if I wanted to focus on a particular car park asset, for example, or the central markets, I can start to see different sets of information year on year. So we can start to see when we have particular projects that are successful or not, what sort of impact that's actually happening, having on the organisation itself. We've also turned this into a graphical representation of tonnes of carbon as well. So I won't labour on some of the other projects that we've actually been doing in here, but I'll just show you one more example of some information that we've pulled together from statistical information we've been gathering in the organisation and blending that with some information we've gathered from the ADS. So this is about some really high-level economic indicators across the city itself, so we can start to look at employment conditions of large business types and who is the largest employer across the city. And we can start navigating our way through year on year to start to see different trends of information that's occurring through these particular data sets in a really usable way. So I'll leave it at that for now. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Peter, very much for that presentation. Lobbeck.
Thanks, Peter, for your presentation. I've got one question. I hope you can clarify it for me and the members. It's this relationship between smart organisation and smart city. So I'll use London's language in that regard. I understand that your first endeavours are to get our internal shop in order so that our internal systems can then enable a range of peripherals, I guess, meaning smart parking, smart lighting, and smart a whole host of things. Is that correct? And what is the connectivity between those two things? Meaning that do we have to do this foundational work before which time we're actually able to, you know, extrapolate other external peripherals in order to make our city management more, you know, more effective, I guess?
Through the chair, look, what we've tried to do is create a program of work that's dealing with the current risks across the organisation as far as the systems architecture is currently. And what we're trying to do is create economies of scale around how we start to create that architecture itself. So that technical diagram I showed you really talks to both some of the internal issues of council's administration, but also talks to smart city activities. So we're trying to create those economies of scale to do with both particular parts of those two strategies. But what we're really focused on is customer outcomes. So there's got to be a connected story between a car parking experience for someone on the street and how that translates to an experience actually within the administration and those relationships between those experiences. So if you thought about CRM, for example, or a customer relationship management tool, there's going to need to be a relationship forged with someone that's actually having a car parking experience on the street, but also their experience in paying their rates or actually dealing with some of the internal administrative parts of their business. So what we're trying to do is bring those two things together and make sure that we create those economies of scale that we can deal with both smart city aspirations of council, but also deal with a really smart organisation, but deal in a different way with how we deliver services as a smart organisation.
Got a second part to my, I'll be brief, Chair, second part to my question. From your knowledge, Peter, where does this council, in terms of a smart organisational capacity, sit in comparison to, let's say, other capital city councils around the nation? And how much have we traditionally invested into our IT infrastructure over the years?
Through the chair. Look, just after I started with council, I did some analysis on the spend and our architecture itself. We sit in a very low place. We've got hundreds of thousands of spreadsheets, multiple systems dealing with a duplicate particular pieces of business capability. So our customers are represented in multiple systems. It's very hard for us to be citizen-centric unless we take an approach like this. I could have spent the first 3 years of my time here actually just dealing with some of the issues of systems architecture itself. So And as far as our spend's concerned, historically over the few financial years before my arrival, we're spending between $6 or $7 million a year on this type of work. It was ungoverned and it was within the business focused on point solutions. So whilst this seems like a program of significant spend, it's actually quite less than we used to spend. And it's around that consolidation of our effort that's really we're seeing those efficiencies and how we're thinking differently about how we're delivering those solutions.
Thanks, Chair.
Okay, we have now Councillor Rishawn, Councillor Mullany, and then Councillor Summer.
Thank you. Peter, this might be a question for you or even the CEO. I'm all for data. Data's great, and especially if it's used. I'm interested in how the organisation is going to use the data and whether the organisation is at a stage where they can use this to great effect.
Through the Chair, I think what we're trying to show here is not necessarily these are products that we're going to be used that are going to be readily used right now. This is about the effort that we're putting into making sure our data is actually constructed in a way that it is usable. So some of the products that I've shown today are examples of things that we can do and really thought provokers around how we can think differently about our information. I guess historically we had a lack of trust in the information that we're actually using across the organisation. So the building blocks of this architecture is actually bringing those that trust back into the information sets we've got.
But it has to be done with an outcome in mind. So data like this, for instance, what would be the outcome of having this data on hand? How would it be used?
All of the products that you've seen today, we were working really closely with the business itself. And this particular product, what we did is actually go out to consultation with parts of businesses across the city using static forms or particular static pieces of information. So this is information we've always used. It's about how do we create that better level of visibility and usability of this information so we can make better decisions.
Councillor Mullany.
Thank you, Peter. I thought the Lord Mayor's question was very good, and I just wanted to go back to that a little bit. One of the things, if you could just help me clarify in my mind, is you mentioned that prioritisation has come around the risk of what's the highest risk gets the highest priority, which makes perfect sense. One of my questions is, you also said you could spend 3 years on just getting the system architecture correct. When we want this to have impact on the street, we use smart parking as an example. One of my concerns is around how we get that balance right, because smart parking is a game changer for this city. And I don't want us to get bogged down with too much getting the house in order before we can get something on the street. Can you talk to me about that? That's my first question.
Certainly the program has been deliberately constructed to deal with some of the strategic priorities of council. So the reason that we came to council with that reallocation of funding in QF2 this year is to really start to build those underpinning building blocks that we're going to need to actually create that environment that we can get things out onto the street. So as you saw from some of the mapping visualization we've been doing, that's about creating that data architecture that underpins some of those solutions to get information out to people quickly and in real time. So whilst we prioritise some of the work around those building blocks and some of the programs that we're actually dealing with as far as our Smart Org program is concerned, actually also sequencing some of the aspirations around our Smart City program.
So for example, smart parking, what, in terms of the time, part of this, you're building a business case right now, I get that, but Give me an example of when that would be ready to be. I'm using it as an example, I guess.
Through the Chair, the business case itself is due back to Council in September.
My second question is, we talk about the original conversation, about the original motion, the intent was always to give ratepayers and people in the city that really drill down level data. I know this is not the final, I get it, interface, but the existing projects that they can look up, how do they get down to that really nuts and bolts data that impacts them, their house, their street, not just a project in their precinct? How do we get down to that level of what's in it for me kind of data?
Through the chair, this particular part of the platform is the first evolution of where we're seeing going. So it's about creating that sort of unified experience for customers to start interacting with customer with council information. So we see the next evolution of these products around how do we geofence part of the city. So if it was a particular precinct that I was interested in looking at, how do I get information about that particular precinct? So this is just the first part of that building block of the evolution of how we see those interactions with customers changing.
Maybe I'm a bit impatient, I'd just like to see no other factor.
Thank you, Councillor Mullany. We now have Councillor Summer and then Councillor Coronan.
Thank you, Chair. Peter, does this project, Smart Organisation Project, will that collaborate all of the other, you sort of answered the question, but will it collaborate all of the systems, give you one system, so we're not patching on top of different things over the years, will it be one great system that talks to everything?
Through the chair, the purpose of this program is really to look at how we integrate information together and how do we actually start to rationalise some of the systems that we've currently got in place. So whilst it won't be one specific system, it'll be one integrated platform of information and business processes. So what we won't be having is multiple systems dealing with similar capabilities as we do currently. There'll be a reduction in systems, absolutely.
Yeah.
Councillor Clohan. Yeah, thanks, Peter. Just a question I think that relates back to the Lord Mayor's question of you. I mean, you say we're pretty low in terms of the hierarchy of capital cities and their integrated platforms. Do we have to reinvent the wheel given our position on the in the list, or can we actually not reinvent the wheel and utilise what they've actually created in terms of their integrated platforms?
Through the chair, we're certainly not reinventing the wheel, and this is certainly not a rip and replace strategy. This is about how do we use the investments that council has already made in some of their systems and start to build an integrated environment for our customers. But also, the approach we're taking is what the City of Melbourne are using. It's also what the Productivity Commission, who recently released a report about what governments need to do to prepare for digital disruption, recommending. So it's about building digital integrated architectures to start to think differently about how customers are interacting with government. So this is certainly not anything new. And these are the types of approaches that a lot of our major banks are using. Organisations like Jetstar and Virgin Airlines are using this approach, this enterprise architecture approach. And those that are focused on really quality customer outcomes are taking this sort of approach, how they deal with the systems and information architectures.
And one more question about the release of our data, i.e. making it available to everyone, anyone. We hear about how that's really important in terms of economic development opportunities and for startups. Have we to date got any evidence of anyone actually accessing our data for those purposes?
Through the chair, there are certainly people accessing and using our data. I think one of the things that we need to think differently about how we release information is how do we put ourselves into a position to actually construct data in a way that people want to digest. So if you look at this, if you look at the startup community, they're building apps now.
Yeah.
They want to deal with our information through real-time interfaces to our systems and information. So it's about an evolution, how we actually change our thinking about how we actually create information assets that are usable for people.
So by utilising this sort of architectural platform, we will make that information more accessible and more timely.
Absolutely.
Fine, thanks.
Okay, if there are no further questions, then I would like to thank Peter for his commentary on Smart City and Smart Organisation. And if that moves us on to item 8, which Councillor Martin has pulled out, on Smart Organisation, Smart City.
Sure. I'll move as printed chair.
And a seconder, Councillor Mullany.
Yeah, I endorsed it all. It's a no-brainer. It's a great thing. It's expensive, though. Perhaps not as expensive as it has been over the years, but $707,000 in February or March, I think it was. $4.6 million tonight, $7.3 million still to come. for both smart organisation and smart city, and the expensive process of even identifying the business case for smart city to come. But I'm just wondering whether it's possible, and I do see the benefits in the tables of 27, 28, 18 and 19 that will flow to council, but there's no point at which there's a decipherable measurement about what are the labour cost savings. And I'm wondering if we can have that, because that's usually a driver for these kinds of changes. There are efficiencies that flow through personnel. And given that we are borrowing this is all borrowings for ratepayers, we're putting them in hocks to do this, it would be nice to be able to say to them, well, look, you know, there's also a saving in staff costs. And I'm not suggesting that we're sacking people, it's just that obviously you tailor your workforce to the needs. It would be good if we could have that at some stage as well. You're right for that.
Yep, through the chair, we're happy to bring back some more detailed modelling on what we think the short-term and longer-term resource implications are. We've certainly done that, and at the moment that's just being double-checked through a peer review process.
Okay, well, that's great. That's great, I'm happy with it. And yes, more of it, more quickly, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Maloney, you seconded the motion.
I reserve my right.
Okay, you reserve your right. Councillor Bershaw and then Lord Mayor.
Thank you, through the chair. Look, I just really support what Councillor Martin just asked for. Just looking at the table on page 24, the benefits are called intangible, but you've got a monetised benefit going forward, which, you know, could pay for all of our future investment in smart organisation. If we actually have a way of seeing those benefits flow through in a monetised capacity. So it's really, if it's a reallocation of task or time or a reduction in attempts or time or it moves on to other projects, but we actually need to see how that flows back into the organisation for such an investment. So what I don't see from here is a tangible monetised benefit that flows back to the organisation. That's what I'd like to see. So I'm very hesitant to actually support 4.6 million for something where I can't actually see a monetised benefit coming back to the organisation that should, in effect, over the years, pay for the investment in the first place. So.
Thank you, Councillor Bershaw. Lord Mayor.
Thanks, Chair. I support the motion, but I do echo the comments of my fellow elected members. I think this is an exercise of making the intangible tangible and having some kind of regular reporting back to council as we walk this journey. Members, as you know, I was at the World Cities Conference last week in Singapore, and the very, very strong theme, of course, of that conference was smart cities. And if you look at our role, members, in terms of our role to manage and maintain our city, I think we do that very well. But then there's that whole transformational aspect. And if you look at Carbon Neutral Adelaide 2025 and our whole smart city agenda, they are the things which will truly transform our city as we continue to manage it very, very well. So I do speak to this with great enthusiasm. I see this as a huge priority, but I think the message is, Peter, that we need to make the intangible tangible. We need to find systems of measurement of this so that we can communicate to our ratepayers where are the efficiency gains, how are we improving the visitor experience to our city once we start looking at some of these peripherals in terms of smart parking, as Councillor Maloney said, how does this reduce cost in the long run? How does this make the City of Adelaide more competitive? How does it make Adelaide City Council more efficient? They're all the types of things which we're going to want you to report back to us regularly to substantiate this investment. But I wholeheartedly support the investment. I think it's absolutely critical for not only our management, but the very competitiveness of our city.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Abia.
Thank you, Chair, and thank you for your presentation. Look, I remember 6 years ago, I actually was in the same room and I moved the motion for a digital strategy to adopt it on council. We didn't have any of this in place, and I struggled to get $50,000 together for us to get started. Which basically goes to show that it's taken us some time, as you said, to catch up on a lot of things. But I think in the last 6 years, this council has really moved as quickly as it could to try to get to the position we're in today. I think one of the things that we need to note, potentially we may not even see the return on investment on this specific project, but one of the things I want to see is how we can embed such projects into delegation from a council perspective. I mean, this should be our bread and butter. This shouldn't be a special project that comes to council for us to sign off on. So we're able to give it the go ahead and you know, manage it that way. I mean, this stuff needs to be under delegation of the CEO. This is our roads, rubbish. This is it. I mean, this is at the core of it all. And look, I'm delighted to hear a lot of the positive feedback from council members on this, because it means we're all on the same track to try to head to churches and reach that. And you'd know this out of anyone, Peter, really, if we don't have the buy-in politically, it's very challenging to push these things through, because it is not tangible. We're not buying a cup. It's somewhere up in the cloud. It's challenging. Some things will work, some things will not work, especially when we're pioneering some of the stuff that we're trying to achieve in our city. So there is definitely some risk attached to this. But the question here is the risk appetite, but also the return on investment for that risk. We've seen already with some very small open data packets what some of the entrepreneurs are doing around our city over the last 5 years. I've attended practically every single one of those open data network meetings, and it's amazing what they can pull together in 24 hours. So for us, it's about equipping ourselves to the best that we can. Not for us to come up with the solutions, it's for the community to come up with solutions. So potentially we might not be able to measure the tangibles, but imagine that we don't need to develop a system at which people can find out what parklands are empty or not, or which ones are watered or not watered. If that information is all out there in the cloud, there'll be potentially entrepreneurs and startups that will build add-on solutions to our council solutions, to our existing council solutions, which end up sitting on our website as APIs. So they're literally just additions for people to just take them and build them into their own businesses. And that's how the ecosystem will build moving forward. So look, at this is a very exciting opportunity. I echo Councillor Milani's discussion in relation to the parking, but you sort of somehow need to build the internal mechanism to some degree to launch the external one. But I think we're also hungry to see things happen, and we're so excited to see things happen that we want to see the tangible, and that's the challenge, and that's how you manage expectation from an IT perspective. What you've done here is you've built the scope of the project organizationally. If we're not in tune and we can pick all that up and get our organization straight, it's quite impossible to deliver on objectives. It took me, in a very small business which services about 45,000 clients in our own business, the good part of 2 years to build our system, which cost us over $100,000 in our own small business, which we didn't see the return of until now. You know, it took us a better part of 3 or 4 years, and then to get the team on board and the customers on board, it's all a lot of, you know, blood, sweat and guts out until you get to that sweet spot. So look, it's not going to be an easy ride, but it's an exciting ride that we're actually doing this. And just in my experience of attending some of the conferences overseas on behalf of the city, Adelaide is looked at as a city of opportunity, because we can database our whole city in like literally a month. I mean, it's not a very challenging city to database. It's quite, the grid setup of our city is quite easy to be able to image. There's a lot of things that are not surprises. There's not one way, you know, there's rarely you'd see a one-way street in our city. It's a very easy city today to manage, to database, and to create the data around it. What it's going to look like in 10 or 15 years from today, it's going to be completely different. So this is the right opportunity, and this is the sweet spot to enter the market. So look, I'm 100% supportive of this, and I think we need to explore this further, because the weakness in this, which I see, and the risk in this to which I see, is that future councils may not support it. So the biggest issue for us is, like, you can't buy a computer that costs you $100,000 today and not keep investing in the software every year to make sure it's up to speed and up to date. So this is it, members. You start this process, you can't stop. And this is the challenge of it, because the minute you fall behind in technology, you're left behind. And I think this is where the commitment needs to lie from us politically, but also from an admin perspective, that this needs to fit in within a CEO delegation of somehow, somewhat in the future, because this needs to be our bread and butter. This is exactly just as good as roads, rates and rubbish.
Thank you, Councillor Abbey, Councillor Wilkinson, and then Councillor Milani, because he was able to write it.
Didn't that be summing up?
wasn't, I didn't move it.
Remove Councillor Martin.
Thank you.
We don't have
Chair.
I've
got the floor. I'm supportive of approaches where we spend something now in order to save money long term. I think that's why, even though we do have to borrow to do it, if it ultimately pays dividends, particularly when money is relatively cheap these days, I think that's a prudent investment. But I also think that the return we look at is not just of basically saving to the ratepayers and lowering our cost of operations through smart technology, but also improving the way that the city operates, such that, for example, with the smart parking at the moment, if you look in Flinders Street or Sturt Street, where we've got metered parking and no one is parking in the street because our pricing is so high that no one's prepared to pay what the price is. So that's our provision of on-street parking isn't working for the users of the city because of the way that it's priced. So I see there's an opportunity to take this smart parking thing for us to optimise things so we get a sweet spot so that all of our on-street parks are fully utilised, albeit a cheaper rate, but they're fully utilised. So rather than trying to deter people from coming into the city, you know, by car, we're encouraging that with reasonable parking so that we're getting the same dividend back to council through full utilisation of our parks, which is currently not happening. So I see there's an opportunity to take that as an example to use this technology.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Mullaney, you were saying then Councillor Martin to sum up.
Yes, there's just one word I wanted to say. Two, actually, sum up.
All right, all those in favour? That is carried. Our next item is item 11, items to receive a note. Neil, which leads us to item 12 of business. Councillor Mullaney has a motion on notice, recognition of the 20th anniversary of the tour Down Under. And Councillor second, Councillor Mullaney.
Thank you, I'll be very brief. This is fairly straightforward. I think we all agree that the Tour Down Under is a great event, and in anticipation of its 20th anniversary coming up in 2018, we need to start planning as to what that might look like, what our involvement might be. There's a lot of other stakeholders in this in terms of state government, tourism and arts. But I really think that it's an opportunity for us to, we are the home of the tour in terms of the village and the first stage and the last stage. And we love the fact that people come and visitation is high and our city is alive. And I hope this would give people an opportunity to come to the city all year round to commemorate the event and their favourite cyclists. I actually got a lovely phone call from the grandfather of Rowan Dennis yesterday after the advertiser wrote a story on this, and he just wanted to remind me to please don't forget his grandson, who was a 2015 winner. And I thought that was very cute. He's very proud of his son and grandson, and he's a good local Adelaide boy. So there's a lot of, this is just calling for some information. It's calling to go to the key stakeholders that may partner with us in this. There's a lot of design and location and et cetera to be considered. What it looks like, I don't know, but I do hope that we can have some kind of legacy in the city that celebrates the event and those that have worked very hard to build the event to what it is today.
Thank you, Councillor Mullaney. If there are no other speakers to this, Councillor Martin.
Yes, I would like to speak to it. I don't agree with this, although I have found the dialogue on commercial and ABC radio fun. And I heard the proposal for a Walk of Fame for cyclists compared to a swimming pool, a memorial swimming pool for an air show. It doesn't really make sense, but it could be fun. We'd have 19 pavements. Well, actually, we take seven out, actually, because the winner of seven of those is in some strife because of drug taking. But I guess my principal concern, quite apart from the issue that the event has been somewhat tainted by drugs in sport, is that why do we have to memorialise everything? What Yeah, it's still going. I mean, we don't memorialise, you know, significant events like Clipsal or the Grand Prix or, you know, and there's nothing for the Chapel Brothers. What about the Chapel Brothers? We could have some kind of memorial to them. But look, the problem with memorials for sporting events is that you actually devalue the currency. I think it's entirely proper to honour the service and sacrifice of people who fought in wars in the name of the country, and particularly those who've lost their lives. But when you start then memorialising bike races, which, you know, bring enormous benefits to the state, there's no question about that. It's a great opportunity for people around the world to see what Adelaide and South Australia looks like. It brings people and money to the state, and it's enjoyed by South Australians. But it is just a cycling event. And just think about all of those other memorials that are so significant in Adelaide, and what you do to them by, you know, erecting a pavement, in my view, devaluing them. So I won't be supporting this, and I propose that maybe a motion that suggested a party would be quite acceptable. Now, a party for a 20th is a great idea. We could have balloons, we could have streamers, we could have a street parade, we could have the Lord Mayor on the balcony blessing all of the cyclists. We could give away free hot dogs and drinks and have a civic reception even. Now, that would be a fitting way of marking a 20th. But the proposal as it stands is, in my view, far, far too much.
Lord Mayor and then Councillor Moran.
Thank you, Chair. Well, I very enthusiastically support this, and I wouldn't call it a memorial because, to my knowledge, no one's passed away. But this is a celebration, and I think this is a celebration of success, which I think is something which in Adelaide we must do more of. When people do great things, we should celebrate them, we should support them, we should shout it to the moon and the stars. This event, I think we should do anything to support this event. It's that important to Adelaide. If we look at our agenda to internationalise Adelaide, Tour Down Under, tick. If we look at healthy lifestyles, Tour Down Under, tick. If we look at hotel rooms and restaurants and cafes and tourism and participation, tick. Why wouldn't we support this, members? I think it's...
Men in Lycra, that's why.
Men in Lycra, well, yes, for some, tick. This sits perfectly, and this is celebrating those who do great things in our city. Why wouldn't we support it, members?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Councillor Moran and then Councillor Farahan.
Look, we do support it. I find it mildly offensive to suggest that if you're not supporting this motion, you're not supporting Tour Down Under. I totally support Tour Down Under. But to be serious, when the citizen Tasha used the word partner, then I'm scared. The motion doesn't mention any monetary contribution by us, but clearly that's what's been flagged, as any partnership is. It's a wonderful event among many other wonderful events. We don't stick one for the Clipsal, we don't have a memorial for the Grand Prix, we don't have a statue for the Festival of Arts or the Fringe. Instead, we sensibly spend the public's money on supporting them in a financial way, as we do all these events. I think it's cloying to suggest we put a statue of a bike up there. It's almost in the same, if my memory serves me well, giving the keys to Lance Armstrong. I sat here and had to listen to the cloying nonsense from the then Lord Mayor about how bed nights, the city, fantastic, anybody that votes against it's an idiot. Well, I voted against it and I proved I wasn't an idiot. And I'm voting against this. I can tell you that if you ask any cyclist how they'd rather have the money spent, it would be on fixing Frome Road. It would be on putting new bike paths out. It would be on doing bike infrastructure. It is silly to put up a statue of a bike in Victoria Square.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. Councillor Clarahan.
Look, I think it's quite appropriate to acknowledge the 20th anniversary of the Tour Down Under, especially given that it receives worldwide coverage, as do, you know, the Tour Italia, the Tour de France, etc. Some of us are looking a bit bleary-eyed from very late nights watching the Tour de France. I don't know that I'm actually in favour of a fixed piece of art to commemorate the 20th anniversary. Taking a cue, I suppose, from the Tour de France, I think if we wanted to do something, some ephemeral art would be fabulous. And if you're a viewer of the Tour de France, for example, you see wonderful pieces of art created across the course, throughout the country, be it a ploughed field, be it, you know, a configuration of haystacks or whatever. And given the nature of our tour, well, I think invite people to celebrate the 20th anniversary through some form of ephemeral art, I think is a great idea. I'm just tripping over the notion of a fixed piece of art, because as has been said, you know, do we celebrate then the Clipsal, the Grand Prix, WOM Adelaide, the Festival of Arts? Where does it start? Where does it end? It might work, happy to investigate, but I really think to get everybody involved and to encourage everyone along the Tour Down Under route to actually contribute to the commemoration would be, to me, a much more inclusive and memorable occasion. So yes, I think we should celebrate the 20th anniversary. It's a great marketing tool for Adelaide and South Australia. However, my preference would be avoiding the thing of fame. As someone said, you know, we'll be falling off our bike re certain drugs in sport history. But let's do something playful, something fun, something that everybody can partake of, something that we can all enjoy. Let's go for some ephemeral art along the way.
Thank you, Councillor Clarahan, Councillor Wilkinson, and then Councillor Mullany to sum up.
I think the event's great for the state, and no one would ever argue with that, but I'm more in the camp of making a big to-do of the event, so when people are watching it on television, there's something that people watching around the world on television see. I can't see the international television thing beaming in on the Walk of Fame or a statue of a bike or some thing that's sort of done. And what happens at the 30-year thing? You know, do you have another statue at the 30-year mark? Or, I mean, I think making something more ephemeral like that, or, you know, like floodlighting the buildings that are on the roof so that when they have the television cameras looking down William Street, it's oh, that's a good point. But doing something, and you know, a big to-do with everyone involved, of course, would be appropriate, but I'd rather see that sort of celebration. And I do have my reservations about, you know, like there was that very embarrassing thing with the path that was named after cyclists who then it was found through drugs, and then that was very embarrassing for all and sundry. So we've got some Walk of Fame, and you have, you know, the ones that Lance Armstrong won, you know, like that. So I appreciate the sentiments of the movement, but I think there could be some better ways that we could do it rather than some permanent structure, which we don't have for others in our face to support.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. Councillor Vershaw.
A quick word. Look, I'm actually happy for them to explore it if they're going to do it, because I'm always in favour of public art in the city. I actually think the more public art we can get in the city, the better. And I would love every single festival we've ever hosted to have some public art that celebrates what they do, because it is a festival state. And we, you know, if it's done in a way that celebrates what we do here.
Yeah.
What I would also like if Councillor Malani would care to add something, that perhaps in recognition of the 20th anniversary, this report could also bring back other ways we can celebrate the 20th anniversary within the same.
You have to add that because I can't.
Am I able to add that?
If Councillor Malani approves you to add in some wording.
Am I allowed to do it on notice? Can I vary on notice?
A variation with the approval of Councillor Abiyana seconder.
Can I, am I able to do it?
Yes.
Oh, then I will, yes.
Can you just add that in addition?
I'm just being told I can, so.
This is as a variation and I've been told that we can do it as long as the mover and seconder approve.
Yes, I'm happy with that.
Yep.
Can Councillor Vershaw please advise on the wording?
So after the brackets of sport, so to explore the potential work key steps and stakeholders to celebrate this event and or to create. And or, that's it.
Thank you, Councillor Vershaw. Councillor Malani, do you approve? And Abiyad? Okay, just as a show of hands as accepting the variation. Excellent. Are you done, Councillor Vershaw? Then Councillor Malani to sum up.
Thank you, thanks Councillor Vershaw for your input. This is not a prescriptive motion. It doesn't, it's about celebration. It's meant to be inclusive. It's about investigation. I'm not even suggesting we pay for it, I don't even know what it is yet, but I do know that it's a significant event and we should start planning for it. I think it could be art, it could be some, Victoria Square, it could be somewhere else, I don't know. Maybe we could commemorate the other events as well. This is not about commemorating a person or a sportsman or a anyone in particular. This is about an event. This is about the anniversary of the event. And I'm actually, you know, I hope we are quite strategic about this because it should entice more people to visit the city, not just within that week of January, but all year round. So I do think that that is, you know, something we're all aiming to achieve, to create spaces where people want to spend time in the city, and I think that this could be a part of that. I hope it is something, Councillor Clarahan, amazingly artistic. I don't think it needs to be a bike. It has to be. It could be something really quite special. So I urge members to give our staff through this motion the authority to go and have a conversation about us being open to giving a piece of public realm potentially or another form of celebration. Let's give them the authority to go and have that conversation with tourism, with the minister, with state government, with arts SA, all of the above. And that's what I'm asking you to support. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Malani. All those in favour? Those against? That is carried. Okay, item 13, other business. We have questions without notice and motions without notice, of which we have both. Councillor Martin has a question without notice, which he will need to read.
Yes, thank you, Chair.
And then I will call for comment from the administration.
Okay. Question on without notice is, could the administration confirm if the Prince Albert College Old Collegians Football Club has applied for a limited club licence, for which I understand the Liquor Licensing Act 1997 allows the supply and consumption of liquor to members and up to five guests on the approved premises of Park 9 from 5 a.m. to midnight 6 days a week and 11 a.m. to 8 p.m. on Sundays. 1.2, whether any licence granted by the authority would apply to the existing club rooms and oval as well as to any new club rooms that were built on the site. 1.3, if and how the hours nominated in the application differ from the proposed hours contained in the documents issued for the public consultation on the new club rooms. And 1.4, if council will be making a submission to the Liquor Licensing Authority by next week's closing date for submissions and the nature of that submission.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. And now for the administration, Sean will provide some comment, after which we won't have any debate or discussion about this.
Thank you, and through the Chair. So Prince Alfred Old Collegians Football Club has applied for a limited licence, and such a licence, if it was issued unconditionally, would allow for trading hours as described in the question without notice. Administration has intervened in the matter on Council's behalf. The intervention was lodged on 15 July and is scheduled to be heard on the 3rd of August. The licence can't be granted without Council's consent as landlord. The proposed licence is to cover the existing club rooms and a portion of the oval, and administration's intervention will in part look at the physical definition of the licensed area. Any subsequent approved building works would require an application to vary any existing liquor licence that was current at that time, and administration would also intervene at that time to ensure appropriate conditions apply to any new building. The recent consultation on the proposed new building by Prince Alfred Old Collegians Football Club in Park 9 indicated that the applicant intended to continue its existing practice of trading on game days only. Our understanding is the applicant is not seeking to trade more frequently. They currently need to apply for separate temporary licences for each game day, and a limited licence would eliminate the need to do this. But irrespective of the applicant's intent, administration's intervention will seek to ensure the condition of any limited licence is consistent with the current trading conditions.
Thank you, Sean. And that moves us on now to our motion without notice by Councillor Malani on laneways, which she does need to read aloud and seek a seconder.
Thank you, Chair. My motion is that Council administration prepare a report on the number of private roads in the council area, where they are located, and investigate the ways in which council can engage the owners to encourage investment into the upgrade, including determining which of them may be deceased estates.
Oh, Councillor Wilkinson has registered his intent to second, so Councillor Malani.
Thank you. I think, look, we've had a good bit of an example of this tonight with Tavistock Lane, which is a deceased estate. I remember when Amalfi wanted to do something with that lane, but they couldn't because we couldn't approve it and no one owned it. It was a deceased estate, and so it was kind of this conundrum. But what I believe is there's around about 130 of these like laneways. And we're not saying that we want control of them, because that would be an incredible maintenance hit, but we certainly want to know who does own them, to try and work out whether it's a carrot or a stick approach. And looking at, you know, that some of them are quite nasty, and when people come to me and say that they're fearful because they're dark and their work access is off one of these laneways, we know that we have to do something about it. So I just would like us to prepare some background information so that we can make an informed decision about how we can move forward with dealing with some of these issues. When someone comes to us and says, I've got a problem with this laneway, we will then know who to go to, where it's at, whether it's a deceased estate, whether we need to do something more about it. And I think that information will be quite useful for us when we make those, you know, further decisions on many more roads to come, as we've done with one of them tonight.
Thank you, Councillor Malani. Councillor Wilkinson.
Yes, no, I've had discussions with the council staff on this topic, and when I was working before the council of the planning department in 1990, I would frequently have discussions with our surveying department. Every time there's a development application lodged, which had a garage or something, or some reliance upon one of the laneways, I had my direct experience of just how problematic it was that we had all of these laneways, many of which were old system land. And I think for us to really delve into, because really at the moment it literally is like no man's land, and a lot of these are just weed infested things that everyone's saying, not my problem, but you know, what makes a lot of the city work is all these laneways, yet everyone's sort of hands are saying, not my problem. And I think we need to, I like Councillor Malani's idea of engaging with Jason property owners to get some buy-in, so they will get the benefit of the improved utility that these laneways actually contribute to the cost. I had one next to my own house in North Adelaide where I paid for the bitumening of the laneway, private lane, same sort of situation. So having that dialogue with property owners and knowing the council is sort of behind trying to get some things happening with them, improving the servicing, you know, the occasional lighting, provided it doesn't cause glare problems in people's backyards and things. But I think is a positive move that we should grab this nettle.
Thank you, Councillor Wilkinson. I've got Councillor Moran, but actually Justin's registered. He would like to comment, which I'll permit.
And it's more of a question of clarification. The way that the motion is worded, I just want to share the interpretation, is that the report that will come back not only identify the potential private roads, where they're located, which in itself is not a problem, but it goes on to say, and investigate the ways in which council can engage the owners to encourage investment. Is the intent of the motion that every single one of the private roads that we have, that the report will detail who the potential owners are and what strategies may be put in place to try and progress the development?
Yeah, can I give some clarity? That's a good question. So what my intent is that we look at how many there are, which I think indicatively we've got some idea, that where they're located, investigate the ways that we can perhaps have influence, but I think then would come the next step if we wanted to go and find out who owned them all, because there is, I know, probably an investment to be made in doing that. So I would be seeing that as the next step, because then we'll know how many we're looking for. Does that help?
Thank you, Councillor Kalani, Councillor Moran, and then Councillor Farahan.
Yeah, well, I will support this motion, but we already have that information in quite detail. If you ring up about any lane, the administration can tell you whether there's an owner and they know of an owner. Mm-hmm. So that's all done. So I would have preferred this motion to go to the next step straight away and investigate incentives for the lanes that council doesn't, investigate incentives for privately owned or non-owned lanes, and identify lanes that the council may wish to take over. All this work's been done before. We have quite a set strategy that if there's a lane that people want to make public or council owned, it has to be brought up to a certain standard that council is acceptable to council to take over. Council will never taken a lane over that was below par and done it up themselves. So I think obviously with a new council and a new administration, it's difficult to get any corporate history here, but all the information on the lanes has been done, because in the past we've asked for it and we've had briefings and workshops on it and we've gone through it lane by lane. So I'd hate the staff to go, the administration to go off chasing hares trying to do that. If you can't find that information, bring up a previous administrator somewhere and find out where it's logged, because that is an enormous task. It took us years and years and years, because you have to chase down the who owned the lane in the first place. Are there relatives, existing relatives? Are they contactable? I just want to assure the administration, current administration, that work has been done and that information is available. And then we can quickly go on to the next step of, I agree with the sentiment of this motion that there are some very degraded lanes in the city and we need to work out how we can do it. But I don't want us to set off the hares chasing information that already exists and redoing work that has been done.
Thank you, Councillor Moran. Councillor Clarahan, and then Councillor Malani to sum up.
That was my concern. What would be the benefit and the cost to our administration to undertake this exercise? If the information's there already, fantastic. I think that's what we need to know first, is the information there, or is it going to take up an officer's time and energy when they should be working on another of our strategic projects? This is the sort of thing I think that we've got to be very careful about in terms of railroading our administration into chasing these rabbits down burrows when we really wanted them to be getting on with our strategic plan. I think this is a really dangerous thing to undertake without understanding how much time it's going to tie someone up in the administration, how much is it going to cost to follow through with this. if the information is not already available. I'd like to get that information back before, as I said, we go chasing any rabbits down burrows.
Thank you, Councillor Clarahan. Lord Mayor, and then Councillor Mulani.
Thanks, Chair. I think the wording of this motion is quite reasonable. If it was to be along the lines of just providing us with some guiding principles in terms of solutions. So we're not looking for specific solutions about a specific laneway at this point in time. Out of curiosity, I'd be very interested to know where they all are, if there was a map. But I think it's guiding principles on when matters like the one that's come before us tonight already come before us, we've got a series of guiding principles on which we can draw upon. I think that might be the aspiration that the council is looking for.
Thank you. Yeah, look, the guiding principle on this for me is a strategic plan. We have a priority to have a safe city and an activated, stimulated city. I've asked admin for information on a number of lanes, and we haven't been able to get to the bottom of it, which is what's triggered me to ask this question. So I don't think that we do have all the information we need, and I'm not suggesting we go out and spend a lot of money on delving into this. I'm asking us to work out which ones they are and which ones we know their status and which ones we can easily get information from. I'm open to picking up on Councillor Moran's point and putting in a word, or maybe I'll get the administration to take on notice to prioritise which ones are the priority ones for us to consider,
because I can't do that.
I've asked them to take it on notice to prioritise which are the key lane ones that we might want to look at. This is not about spending money on people's offices' time. This is about a bigger picture around what lanes are unsafe. Where do we have problems? How do we fix the problem? Because quite often we don't know how to fix the problem because it's not our lane. But we therefore then need to go and be able to get the information on whose lane it is. And in the case of Tavistock, it is a deceased estate. So we do need to work out where we can impact, where we've got gaps, and get the information. We don't have it now. I've asked the question. Obviously, I'm not putting up a pie in the sky motion without having asked some questions already. So I urge you all to support this so that we can fix laneways that are actually got some nasty, they're dark and they're unsafe, and we need to get to the bottom of how we can fix it.
Those in favour? That is carried. Item 14, item seeking exclusion of the public.
No, it's not a motion.
Oh. Sorry, my apologies. Councillor Martin has a motion without notice. Sorry, I just saw this one.
That's okay. It's
Bastille Day notice. Terrorist attack, which I'd ask you to read and then seek a seconder.
Yeah, sure. That the Economic and Community Development Committee recommends to Council that Council request that the Lord Mayor convey to the Mayor of Nice, Monsieur Philip Pradal, its condolences to the city and its people for the tragic loss of life and injuries sustained in the terrorist attack on Bastille Day.
Councillor Moran registered her intent to seconder first.
So you can register, can
you? She put her hand up.
May I speak? Thank you. Look, I just want to note that on Friday night, Council organised a vigil in Victoria Square on Friday night at 8 o'clock, I think it was, and there was another yesterday. For those of us who attended the Bastille Day function in Town Hall, it was a particularly somber occasion. I'd note too also that the ambassador who was in attendance and who asked us to observe a moment's silence during the proceedings was actually, by coincidence, here during the last terrorist attack in Paris at Bataclan. And he was here also on the occasion of the Bastille Day event. Now, I feel particularly for the people of France, having been singled out
so many times for terrorist attacks, and this one apparently by the Islamic radical group ISIS. I condemn all terrorist attacks, but I can only imagine how this has affected the national psyche. And I'd be grateful if the Lord Mayor would pass on this city's condolences to the people of Nice.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Moroney seconded.
I reserve.
You reserve your right. If there are no further speakers, I'll take it back to Councillor Martin. Those in favour? That is carried. And now we go to item 14, item 16, exclusion of the public if required, which if there's not. Item 15, confidential items, there is none. Item 16 is closure at 7:45.
Conflict, I want to declare.
Members, I'll declare the Finance and Business Services Committee meeting reopened on the 19th of July 2016 at 7:45 p.m. And I just want to remind you all that we are still streaming live, and that this meeting will also be recorded for publishing on the internet. The Finance and Business Services Committee acknowledges that we are meeting on traditional country, the Kaurna people of the Adelaide Plains, and pays respect to elders past and present. We recognise and respect their cultural heritage, beliefs and relationship with land, and we acknowledge their continuing importance to the Kaurna people living today. I'd like to note that Councillor Antic and Councillor Deputy Lord Mayor Hender are currently on leave. Can I have someone please move the confirmation of the minutes? Moved by Councillor Malani, seconded by the Lord Mayor. Any debate? If there's none, I'll put that. All those in favour? All those against? That item is carried. Members, there is no public forum. There also isn't a Chair's verbal report. And before I move to items to be dealt with on block, I do note that we are having to deal with a review of editorial practice in relation to a matter raised within council at a previous date that would need to be addressed today. And I believe we do have someone here from Kelly Jones that will be representing. Hello, how are you? Sorry to keep you waiting so far. But members, I'll just seek leave from you on this issue, potentially to consider this item so we can have our legal advisor then leave. Otherwise, in mind of making sure ratepayers are not having to pay money, extra money for legal advice or keeping legal advice waiting. So can I have that someone move? Move the exclusion to the public by Councillor Malani, seconded by Councillor Clarahan. Councillor Martin, you have your hand up?
Yes, I wish to speak against that.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you. Look, I think that this matter has been dealt with, and if you note the recommendation, it is that the document exonerates council of any wrongdoing and any employee of any wrongdoing. Therefore,
Councillor, you need to address it. Firstly, it's confidential.
Yes, I understand that.
So you can't bring that issue up, as you just said it in that statement, that is not allowed to be said. The only thing you can speak to right now is whether you choose for it to be heard in confidence or outside confidence.
And that's what I'm arguing. I'm arguing because that is the finding, then this is a matter about which there should be full transparency. There can be no damage to council's reputation.
Well, you could raise that. You've put your argument forth. Does anyone else want to debate that item? Be it that if there's none, I go back to Councillor Malani to close on the exclusion to the public. Summed up, I put the exclusion. All those in favour? All those against? That item is carried. If I could just have members of the public be excluded for this item. Brief one at a time, just so we could receive legal advice. until that item. Apologies. believe we're moving on to item seven, where currently Councillor Malani and the Lord Mayor have declared a conflict. If they can both state their conflict to the committee and exit the room.
Chair, if I may, seven and eight. I'm going to item seven and eight.
Yep, okay, we'll do that.
Because I'm on the authority.
So, Lord Mayor, Chair, not all management authority board members.
No, noted, thank you, Lord Mayor, and thank you, Councillor Malani. Members, we are dealing with item seven and item eight once the Lord Mayor and Councillor Malani leave. We'll start off with item seven first. Okay, item seven, members. Anyone want to move this item? No one wants to move. I have no seconder. Okay, well.
I'll move something.
Councillor Moran put her hand up first.
I move that this matter be deferred to.
Councillor Moran, can you use your mic, please? Thank you.
Doors.
They don't need to be shut. The Lord Mayor just needs to be far away, and Councillor Malani as well.
To just preface what I'm saying, I'll ask you to help me with this. I think the raise is too much, but I understand that the current rate is a bit low. Could I defer this to look at a more moderate increase? Would that be it?
So basically, you would be, instead of approving the following rates and remunerations, you would be deferring. If you want me to assist you, so change the word approves to defer, and also two would be approved to defer, and then you insert item three with a. So you've said defer item one and two, three, bring back a report on a more suitable remuneration? Is that what you prefer?
Yeah, yeah.
Or a reduced remuneration? Or
a more suitable, I think that was implicit in what I was saying.
Just Councillor Moran, just quickly though, I think just, I've got the CEO here hot on the trigger. I think what he's going to say to me is that they've provided their advice, the most suitable advice. So I guess it'll be a matter for council to make a decision if they choose
all right,
otherwise.
Well, I'll go back to more modest. What's a better word? More appropriate, reduced amount.
Yeah, but it's from the advice I'm receiving from the CEO that their advice put to us is a suitable advice that is benchmarked and in their opinion is the best possible advice for council.
I'd be happy to remove the word suitable, Chair, and ask for advice on modest sounds a bit.
Reduced.
Yes, I think what we're looking for here,
reduced
just from the chair to assist you.
Increase. I don't want to reduce the remuneration, I want to reduce the increase.
So the ultimate outcome here, my advice to you as the chair, this is the best possible advice you have today on the day. It's a matter for this committee to make a decision on what the remuneration would be. Because
okay.
That's the best advice we've got. The admin will not come back to us with another advice. That's the best advice they've got.
What's the increase now? 20%, isn't it? Is that the percentage increase?
Can I ask a question?
Just one second, Councillor, please. I've got Councillor Moran to hold.
What's the percentage to pay 20% more? Okay, it'll change 20% to 10%.
Okay.
This is off the top of my head, really.
Well, that's exactly what it is. After you've been given advice, that's the best.
Mr. Presiding Member, I don't think that the administration are the purveyors of all godly knowledge. They give us some advice and we adjust it. So don't sort of say to me that I'm being naughty because I'm not taking.
I definitely did not say
the
that. I'm saying.
Omni, they're not geniuses. And
yeah.
No.
But what the advice I've received is this is the best possible advice from administration to date. If council believes it's not suitable, council's within its remit to change it. You just need to document the change. Can I send it back for more advice? Because that's the advice we have.
Is Councillor Moran finished? May I speak?
Just still has the floor, so I'm just trying to work out what
okay,
Councillor Moran.
The increase be in line with Category 1, Level 6,
as in point seven.
Well,
which is what you recommend.
Yeah.
That's what we got.
Well, that's what you got.
That's what we have.
Oh, is that what the 10% increase for the people who chose to?
we've got advice from KPMG.
Yeah, these figures are less,
The item, I've received another bit of advice from CEO. We are currently going to go through a charter review. So if you wish to defer it until the charter review is done, then the matter could be deferred until the charter review
yes.
is
perfect.
Done. Would you like to do that and bring it back?
Yes.
So Councillor Moran, you are moving that this is deferred to be looked at as part of the charter review and brought back to council in due time.
Yep.
Is that what you'd like to move? Seconded by Councillor Martin. Councillor Moran, would you like to speak to this or should we
summed up?
So Councillor Martin, would you like to speak as a seconder?
Yes, and look, the point that I wish to make is that I'm not convinced by the administration's proposal that we should base remuneration for the Run and Wall Management Authority on the remuneration of government boards. I think it's a nexus that I don't want to see. A more appropriate response would be to provide a CPI increase that's in pretty much step with what applies to the normal remuneration of councillors. So it is that nexus which concerns me, and I'd ask the administration to look at that. And the second thing is, I don't accept, and that may only be a short period, but I don't expect that we should be approving retrospectivity for any kind of monetary arrangement here. It should be prospective always. So those are the two significant things to me. Break the nexus, make it much more in line with what is normally applied to councillor remuneration, and no retrospectivity.
So members, Councillor Wilkinson to speak to the deferral or against the deferral? This is what it is at the moment.
I support the deferral. The DAP members get $500 compared to this. And I know how much work is involved in that, for example. Someone who put a lot of time and effort into that form, which is a very important one. I would thought they should be more in check. I also have a question with the administration. In the report there, it makes reference to directors, and then it shows that the people who are currently on the board refers to the chair, and then directors, and then councillor, Lord Mayor and councillors. It doesn't refer to the elected members on the body as directors. As for the purpose of this, are they taken to be also directors? Thank you.
Thank you. Members, any other debate? Councillor Moran, sum up. I put this deferral motion to you. All those in favour of deferral? All those against? Just hands up again. All those in favour? 1, 2, 3, 4. All those, or 5, sorry. All those against? That is carried. And now we move on to item 8.
I'd like to propose an amendment, Chair.
On item 8?
Yes, and it is exactly the previous amendment.
Okay, so this is in relation to approving the Rundle Mall Management Authority strategic plan for the 16-20, including Attachment A, and you want to move to defer this?
Yes, I think Councillor Moran said she'd second that, didn't you?
Just on, before you speak to it, does this have any implications at all around Council's requirement of receiving any strategic plan or anything like that?
Not
time sensitive. So we have Amanda with us in the gallery. If you have any questions, Councillor, would you like me to ask Amanda to join us?
It's a matter more for the board, I think, than Amanda. My principal concern in this is that at 7.2, it recommends...
So if you're going to speak to it, if you're not going to ask a question, I might just have you move what you would like to move and have that seconded, and then you may speak to it.
Moved and seconded by Councillor Moran.
So the matter be deferred to be looked at as part of the charter review brought back in due course. So moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Moran. Councillor Martin, you have the floor.
Yes, look, my concerns, and I would seek some clarification, particularly in relation to the second point, but it's the first point that at 7.2 it's proposed that the authority activate properties, and there's no explanation on how that's expected to be achieved, whether it's through engaging Renew Adelaide or indeed making its own, what's the word I'm looking for, its own discrete investment. And therefore, some direction from the board on what they mean by that would be helpful. But more significantly, the table on page 26 says that the authority will explore potential external funding support from the federal and state government for strategic plan projects. Now, I may be a bit old-fashioned, but it seems to me that that ought to be a matter that is a council concern, to have our authorities and boards separately negotiating agreements with state and federal governments is a matter that would require some debate and a principle established. It's like saying to the kids, you go out and, you know, get yourself a house loan on me. You'd want to be right across it. You'd want to have all of the detail and understand whether it compromises your own financial position or your own future financial position. And so I would like to have that discussion, and perhaps that could be referred to the authority as part of the discussion about the review of its charter. But to confer on the Central Market Authority, the Run-the-Wall Marketing Authority, and any other council entity the capacity to negotiate its own funding agreements with federal and state governments is a substantial move in a direction that I didn't think they were entitled to take.
They usually definitely are, but that'll be a separate matter to discuss, I guess. Councillor Moran, any other members that would like to speak against the deferral or for the deferral? Councillor Martin, to sum up. Members, I put the deferral of the Run-the-Wall Management Authority Strategic Plan 1620 until the charter has been reviewed and brought back in due course. All those in favour of a deferral? All those against? So it's lost. We go back to the original recommendation. Can I have someone move the original recommendation? Moved by Councillor Slammer. Can I have someone second? Seconded by Councillor Verschel. Councillor Slammer, Councillor Verschel. Members, we've had a bit of debate on this already. Any other debate? Councillor Slammer, to sum up. I've summed up now, sorry. All those in favour? All those against? That is carried. If we can just ask the Lord Mayor and Councillor Malani to join us. And we move on to item 11, other business. And we have a motion on notice from Councillor Malani relating to councillors' offices.
So,
Councillor Malani, motion on notice. Well, that's correct. So moved, Councillor.
Yes.
Do I have a seconder in councillors? If you could please pay attention, Councillor Corbell. Sorry, if you could please pay attention. Councillor moving a motion in item 11, and I am seeking a seconder for Councillor Malani's motion on notice. Is there a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Corbell. Councillor Malani, you have the floor.
Thank you. So I've been thinking about this for some time, and thinking about the particular part of the town hall that we have our council offices, our councillors' offices in. And Councillor Corbell's motion got me thinking about what could we use. That was on in regard to the presentation of archives. And I got me thinking, well, what is there a better use for this area of what I would describe as prime real estate in Town Hall? And there may not be, I'm just calling for investigation. I think we live in a world where we've slotted things in that we've always done before, and sometimes we don't have a chance to reflect on, is it the best thing to be doing? I also find that we're not all there all the time. A lot of the offices are dark. That we perhaps don't need these large offices, and also because we sit in these individual boxes, we're not talking to one another. And I take you look at banks, you look at businesses. I work in a co-working space, and co-working spaces really do get conversations flowing. And I just think it would be worth exploring whether we can look at that option for us. in another space, and then give that bit of the town hall back to the public, and it could be, it could have a better purpose. We're doing a civic master plan of the town hall right now, or a master plan of the civic areas of the town hall. So I'd like this to be considered as a part of it. I've spoken to the administration, and they're open to looking at some ideas as to how we can utilise this space in a better way. I don't know. Councillor Corbell's put up one option, but I think also a co-working space would be an option to consider about how we can work better together. So I'm just calling for some information. It's not a done deal. I just want to ask a question.
Thank you, Councillor Marnie. Councillor Corbell, is a seconder.
Thank you. Look, I'll just speak briefly to this. I do support it. I think it's a really good motion. Location is so important in real estate, and Town Hall is in a prime position, and it is frequented by hundreds, thousands of people, and yet they don't have access to quite a segment of this magnificent building. And the corner offices which we have are not really in the best of shape. And I've always preferenced collaborative work environments. I've worked in offices at the university, in schools, at university, studying as a student. And I think the tendency more is to work towards working together and not having your own private space. I would like to be able to have better communication with my elected members when they happen to be at Town Hall with the administration. I think it makes a lot of sense for us to consider opening up that section of Town Hall for another purpose and moving us into another facility or another space, maybe upstairs on another level as an example, where we can achieve some of these things. And it, I think it ties in really well with the motion that I put up on notice at last month's Economic and Community Development meeting, which was about us utilising archives and the treasures that we have down there. It could be that as part of this, these rooms are opened up and we can display some of our treasures in these rooms. That's just one example on a rotational display basis. I don't know. I'm sure there's lots of opportunities, lots of potential there. I do think that it would be a good idea for us to be working closer together.
Thank you, Councillor Corbell. Councillor Martin.
Yeah, look, thank you, Chair. I want to say this is, and you can tell by the diffident manner in which it's put, this is a very confused motion. It's a bit like the Walk of Fame for cyclists, because it's a bit strange in the wording. There are three outcomes that are sought. One is potential uses for the current offices and councillors, the nomination of Eagle Chambers for showcasing of council archives, and three, hot desking. So there are three things in there, and it's not especially clear. But let's treat them separately. And I'm delighted that Councillor Malani has raised this because as someone running large organisations with 24-hour rosters, I know a great deal about hot desking and how it works. It actually goes back to the 90s when Councillor Malani, and I remember her, used to wear those big shoulder pads like we all did. It is that old. It's 25 years old. And I have to tell you, and you only need really Google it, it is not a success. Hot desking went out with the shoulder pads, particularly when it's used in an organisation in just an isolated area. Now, it's been proven, and do Google it, it's been proven that it delivers very few savings, and there's a deal of evidence to suggest that it's actually bad for the health of an organisation, because all of the people surrounded by hot deskers don't like it. And there have been studies that have shown they take more sick leave than everybody else. Now, what Councillor Malani was referring to in a note to us all last week when she said, and I quote, having worked for some time now in a co-working space, and we all would have heard of the benefits on ways organisations now structure their workplaces, e.g. have a look at the new Bendigo Bank offices, I'd like us to consider redesigning the councillor offices with a view to creating a hot work, a hot desk working environment. It's just not, it's not correct. I don't know where that could have come from. What Bendigo Bank and the other banks and big organisations like Google and Microsoft are trialling is, and I'm happy to help out with the name here, is a thing called activity-based work. Now, this concept includes not hot desks, although I suppose you could describe them as that, but they are uniform desks, all of them the same, with a computer, and less of them. That's where the savings come from. What you do is you have fewer desks than you have people. So the standard generally is around 7 desks for 10 people. So there's always a chance that, you know, when you come in here, you might not get a seat. Although it is imperative always in these systems that you have a central booking system. And then you've also got to have, like at Bendigo Bank, you've got to have a clean desk system. So that is, at the end of the day, the desks are cleaned by the cleaner and everything that is left on them is cleaned up, thrown away. Now, the system is underpinned, like at Bendigo Bank, by support infrastructure. And this is crucial to it. You've got to have, for each of the people engaged in the system, a personal locker so that they can actually store stuff. And then you've got to have a team locker as well, because the team shares paperwork, files and the like. And you've got to have a trolley as well, or several trolleys, to move the personal effects and the files between the filing systems. And that then makes it more efficient. Now, there's also usually a quiet, reflective area, and they have these at Bendigo Bank too, I've been there. And the idea is that staff who need to concentrate, where, you know, you've got something that you really need to give some thought to, you have this quiet area where you can think, and you can make confidential phone calls as well. Now, there are also, on top of that, that is the communal desk areas and the personal file and the collective community file and the trolleys and the quiet reflective area, you have collaborative working areas so that everyone gets together and works in them. And like at Bendigo Bank too, they have socially collaborative areas. And there's a whole floor at Bendigo Bank, and I had a tour, it's fascinating stuff. A whole floor devoted to a cafeteria with separate meeting areas squared off with privacy screens so that people can meet. Now, this is a massive, extensive and expensive system that requires a lot of new technology, the portability of phone numbers, for example, and all that. But the sad thing is it doesn't all work, not all the time anyway, and as Councillor Milani would know, one of the biggest proponents of activity-based work, Colliers International, which spent squillions spinning out all of their offices, and in fact sells activity-based work offices and leases them, just a few months ago decided to abandon the practice because it didn't work. They decided they would just have collaborative spaces and keep personal desks. So look, with that in mind, I want to help Councillor Blaney here, and I'm going to propose an amendment.
Councillor, your time's up.
Yes, I proposed the amendment before you said that.
No, you did
and
not.
It's supported by Councillor Milani.
So are you...
I move that we extend the time to allow Councillor...
I will not do that, Councillor. I will not do that. If you are flagging, if her motion fails, that you'll be moving something and return it, that's fine.
Well, look, Chair, I mean...
The rules are the rules.
You
might vote dissent for Chair.
Yeah, please do, try that. 5 minutes is 5 minutes, everyone. So thank you, Councillor. Lord Mayor. And then Councillor.
Thank you very much, Chair. This is looking for a report. I'd be interested to see what the research says about this. So I think that would no doubt be part of that report. I can see the benefits in greater collaboration. I'd want the report, though, from a governance perspective, to provide us some relevance in terms of the Act, in terms of the potential or the lack thereof of caucusing when you've got a group of elected members working together in a shared common space. I think we'd want assurances, members, that there is no risk that that could be, we could be falling foul inadvertently or of some legislation. I think it's important. But I think it's got some merit, I think, for the purpose of the report. Yes, it'd be good to look at. But I would also say that my own view about this when it came back to members for a vote is I would want to see substantial, if not unanimous, member support for something like this, because it's going to affect everyone.
Councillor Moran, and then seconded, then Councillor Slough.
I will move an amended version of the amendment that Councillor Martin was going to move. I move that the council administration prepares a report on options for the introduction throughout the organisation on activity-based working with a view to creating a better work environment that facilitates better working relationships, and 1.2, identifying potential costs and or savings.
Can I have a copy of that, so I guess type, Councillor, please? Do you have a second there, Councillor? Seconded by Councillor Livingston. Councillor Moran, you have the floor until it's typed.
Okay, now this obviously, we are a tiny cog in the corporation of the City of Adelaide. We're not administration, we're not staff members, and so our position is quite different. These officers we've had are very recent and we fought very hard to get them. But my main point, I think, the point that Councillor Martin was going to make is that if a better working relationship, if there's a problem with individual officers, then that is how our administration is set up. So if we want to look at hot desks and they're still in cubicles, it's not a hot desk situation, then it's more important that we look at better ways for the administration to communicate and work. I think it's perfectly okay now, but if we're going to look at anything, we should look at how the administration's structured and how their working desks are. How we, it's said, we could talk to each other, Priscilla, walk 2 metres and come into my office.
You're never there.
I'm not there, but you don't know when I'm never there. When Councillor Martin said you're never there, that means Councillor Mullaney's there all the time. I'm there an adequate percentage of the time. I can store my stuff. And I'm perfectly happy with my office and I will not be moving. To have us working together is not to change an office situation because we're not here 9 to 5. Well, most of us aren't here 9 to 5. And our working situation is by phone and attending meetings. Our office situation is less important. But if this is a new thing that Natasha's identified, then we need to flag it to the administration, not to us. To say the offices are underutilised and you can't speak to each other is ridiculous. They're all in the same spot. There's a secure area. There are other parts if we want to open more public areas. The Eagle Chambers has always been a lockdown secure area for councillors and council staff for very good reasons. So I really don't, if it's not broken, don't fix it. But if Natasha thinks there's a problem, there's more new age ways to have working offices, then go to the workers in the offices, and that is the administration. If we do decide to change the councillors' working environment, then I suggest we include the Lord Mayor and the Deputy Lord Mayor. It's a very recent thing that the Deputy Lord Mayor has been annexed off into his or her own little office done by David Plumwich. It's ridiculous. It creates another position that was never meant to be. The Lord Mayor can join us. After all, who more should we speak to and bounce off than the Lord Mayor, who we would never see because of the situation of our offices. So I would suggest that the Lord Mayor join us in our hot desks and really speak to his council. But I recommend this one as a good interim measure.
Councillor Wilkinson.
Yeah, I'm happy to support this this amendment. We're going to look at the sort of thing a bit of across the organisation, look at the bigger picture. I think the council's office and centres is a small part in that in the broader picture. So I think the board of directors is meritorious.
Councillor Slough, then Councillor Mullaney, then Councillor Martin. Does anyone want to move for councillors to work from home? Save money?
We do anyway. Oh, yeah, we do. I'm in support, Tom, because I'm coming down from the buzz of the hot desk west back across the street to walk into Ghost Town down there most days of the week. There's hardly anyone down there. And it is a waste of expensive real estate. And I actually like the thought of the Hall of Fame corridor and they have some sort of art gallery that's showing, bits of artwork that we have in storage at the moment under the ground. And I'm quite surprised Councillor Wilkins is not on board with this, because this is a great demonstration of all the beautiful heritage we have there. And I'm sure we could find a co-working space around the Lord Mayor's area that you might not have to move too far.
Why don't you all come in?
Possibly. It's a big enough room.
Councillor Malani.
Thank you. Obviously, whatever comes back, whatever options and ideas come back to us, you know, I think the consensus and important of all of that is important. Councillor Moran says she's not giving up her office. Maybe she doesn't have to, but maybe others prefer a different solution. Maybe particularly part of this motion is around about the better use of that space in the town hall. I think that's been missed in this amendment. And the second thing is, I'm talking about options for us. I'm not imposing anything on the staff. That's the CEO's job to do that. And I don't want to interfere in that process. So I don't support the amendment. It doesn't capture my intent around the better use for that part of the town hall. They are quite grandiose offices, and we, Councillor Sam has said that, you know, it's a ghost town. I think it's a waste of space. So I just want us to look at alternatives, what we could do. Maybe there's something fabulous we could do with that space. And I'm willing to give up my space. I'm willing to have a desk that I use in a shared environment. I'm happy to do that. I think that's fine. I'm not there that often. We can, as you say, work from home or work from wherever. We've got iPads and et cetera. So we obviously need good meeting rooms, because we have meetings with community and public and stakeholders and the like. But I don't think this is about imposing this on the staff, and I think that that's not our job. I just wanted to keep it in the scope of the 11 of us plus the Lord Mayor working together to look at some options.
Councillor Martin, then Councillor
Grisel. Look, I support that. I'm quite happy to move to another part of the building. That doesn't concern me at all. I think Councillor Malani has just explained that she doesn't really grasp the concept. That is to say that if you do introduce activity-based work, then you actually rule out Eagle Chambers, because the Australian Gold Standard, and I'd ask the administration to use that, that is the Australian Government Department of Finance guideline on activity-based working, prescribes a minimum 14 square metres per individual and desk as working space. And so, of course, you'd have to knock down the walls in Eagle Chambers. Of course, in some places they do with less, it's down to about 12 and a half square metres, but that rules that out. So, you know, we are freeing up that by looking at activity-based work. But I do think, you know, this is a wonderful opportunity to display some egalitarianism too. And if the Lord Mayor participates, we could also open up that office as a public space. Let people come in and see what a great office it is and the facilities. It won't be like opening the Philippines Palace after the Marcos regime was dethroned, but it will be interesting for people to see the artwork and the comfy couches. And to actually share a desk with the Lord Mayor will save me the awful tyranny of that long walk down the corridor when I get the phone call. He'll be right there. He'll be able to say to me, Phil, we've got to have a talk. I'd also ask...
Actually, you can have your own office.
No, hang on.
You can have my office, and I'm going to move into these fellas.
In the spirit of egalitarianism,
I'll get you your own building.
Councillor Malani, please.
I'm suggesting that the Lord Mayor and the Deputy Lord Mayor should preside with all of us. And I thank Councillor Malani for seeding this idea. It's certainly one of the most creative proposals that's come before us in recent times. It could be an exciting opportunity for Adelaide City Council, and I commend this to members. It will provide an opportunity to look at the economics of introducing this kind of system. And as I've mentioned, you can't just do it for one section of the workforce. It never works. And moreover, the expenditure is such that it is too expensive once you start providing the add-ons that are necessary for the communal desks. I would just say, in concluding, that the idea of turning Eagle Chambers into a display space for archives
is worth looking at as well. I do understand that there would be some considerations and costs related to security, and because the archives themselves are often fragile, the environment needs to be monitored with some control of humidity, temperature and light. Now that may be expensive, but I think that's a perfect environment in which to display not only pieces of art, but documents as well. So I commend the amendment of Councillor Moran to all councillors.
Because you wrote it.
And I haven't seen such a wonderful amendment in some days. So I thank you for that also.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Councillor Corbell.
Thank you. Look, who wouldn't support this, really? Who's not going to support creating better work relationships and better work environments and potentially saving money? I think this is a great motion or amendment. It's just that I've supported this and I would support the other one as well, and I think they're really quite different. One is specifically talking about the Eagle Chambers and a portion of Town Hall where we reside. That's where our offices are, and this doesn't speak to that at all, really. Oh, it kind of does in a very indirect roundabout way. So for me, the intention would be, if I support this, which I will, because I think who wouldn't, I want to make it very clear that my intention is...
You won't have the chance, then.
Yeah, look, I think this is good because it's to do with the whole organisation, but I also think the other one is good too, and this deliberately pulls out everything that I support in the other one. So I'm a little bit torn.
I'll incorporate it.
Hang on.
Right.
No, this can't do that much to the
deadline. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I support this. I think it's good overall. And I don't want to get into the depot though.
Councillor Corbell, you've summed up. On your part? No, this is not. Oh, no, Councillor Clarion, give me a second. I'm saying on her end, she finished up. Councillor Corbell, have you finished? Yes. Councillor Clarion. To the amendment, yes.
Yeah, I think Councillor Mullany's had a Damascus moment. Given that our two cars are very similar, my friends always used to say to me, oh my gosh, you spend so much time at the Town Hall. And I'd have to say, no, it's not my car there, it's Councillor Mullany's.
I say the same thing, by the way.
Pardon?
I say the same.
And I just think, you know, suddenly another work environment's the favoured. And to think that I'll be replaced by a relic, well, I mean, most people would say, yeah, it's about time, I suppose. But I just think that, if we all end up working in the same area or room, this activity-based stuff, as has been suggested, it's a very dangerous line in terms of the Local Government Act and caucusing. And we've already had some hiccups around that one some time ago. And I would think that we're walking on very thin ice in that regard. I think if people wanted to do some more activity-based working, but they might try out the members' lounge. I think the implications of replacing our offices with exhibition spaces could be very, very expensive alternative. So, you know, I'm happy for this to be investigated. But I just need to flag that I'm not totally happy about being replaced by a relic.
Thank you, councillors. Councillor Moran, to sum up on this amendment.
I think Priscilla really has put a finger on it here. This doesn't rule out anything that the previous motion said. It stays silent on the Eagle Chambers, but this is accepting that we are all... this is a report of sort of touching through it throughout the organisation. We're a tiny part of the organisation, so if you really want to make some change, and Natasha thinks it's a better change, I don't know, then it has to be over. Now, if also Councillor Mullany thinks it's such a fantastic change, why would she then say we don't want to impose anything on the staff? This isn't imposing, this is just looking at different ways to have your working environment. Rather than just picking on us, then just highlighting us, which would do very little. How we work and what office we have has made very little difference. We all can pick up our phones, communicate.
I remember we didn't have offices and it was very difficult working from home in seeing people, so we fought hard and long for offices. It's easy to see people just pop into their office. And I do agree with what Sue said, the Damascus moment is amazing because the two cars, there was only one there all day. But
Excuse me.
Say the offices weren't used, the very person who used the office most is disagreeing with the other person that uses the office a lot. And it's irrelevant. The office is there to store our stuff, to meet other people. We can easily pop in and see who's in and who's out. It's close to our secretary. And most importantly, it's secure. But if it's good enough for the goose, it's good enough for the gander. If it's good enough to suggest for us, it's good enough to have a look at over the whole organisation. This doesn't commit us to anything. It just says, have a look.
Thank you, Councillor. I put the amendment presented by Councillor Moran to you. All those in favour of the amendment? All those against? Members, can I see this again? I've had a drop from the Lord Mayor before. All of those in favour of the amendment of Councillor Moran? All those against? So that is carried. That becomes a substantive. Councillor Malani to sum up.
Look, at the end of the day, am I hoping that we can look for options for the space that we're in? I don't believe we should be imposing it on the way that the administration operates. That's their business. But I do urge you to come and have a look at the space I work in, intersecting on Flinders Street. That's where my office is, and it's a great space. I think that there are opportunities for us to give back that space, that prime town hall real estate, to the public. We don't need large offices. We've always done it because we haven't even thought about doing anything else. All I'm saying is, hey, I've just realised that maybe there is something else we could do, thanks to Councillor Corbell giving, you know, triggering the idea. And Sandy's always had a passion of displaying more, you know, archival and heritage pieces. That's one idea of many. I'd like to see us review how we use that whole civic space. And that was part of, that was the true crux of my intent of the motion. So I can only hope that's taken on notice by the administration.
Before we vote, my advice on receiving, we haven't captured the vote properly on the previous one. There's 10 members, there's one member that did not vote, so on the count. So just for the sake of transparency, someone, there was one vote that was not counted.
Do it again.
No, it's five.
Was it 5-4 or 4-6?
5-4.
Yeah. If it's 5-4, it's lost. That's correct. So if all in favour of the amendment put by Councillor Moran, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, all those against the amendment put by Councillor Moran is also 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So that amendment is lost. Okay. So I'm guessing you summed up, Councillor?
Summed up is the same.
Okay, so I put that, all those in favour, all those against, that is carried. Councillor Malani's motion is... Okay.
Sorry.
Members, thank you. So we are moving, we've finalised now. Any other items for discussions, motion without notice or questions without notice? Be it that there's none, members, I declare the meeting closed at 8:46 p.m. Thank you.
No, that's all right.